everybody. It's Amanda, and welcome to the History of FMW episode 41, where we will be going over the year 2013. Brett, can you start us off by summarizing 2012 for everybody?
So the big thing that took place in 2012 was Atsushi Onita's resurgence in popularity. He had two hot feuds going on at the same time, one with the original Tiger Mask Satoru Sayama, which he had a rivalry with Sayama dating back to the early 1980s when Sayama was the top New Japan Junior Heavyweight and Onita was the top All Japan Junior Heavyweight. And then Onita also is feuding with Akebono, which you could say this is the feud that got Onita over for the first time in a non-nostalgic way in over a decade, as this feud is hot. They main evented the Yokohama Bunkin' Gym in a no ropes exploding barbed wire death match, and it's still going strong going into 2013. And then you have Freedoms, who struggle for the first half of 2012 with Jun Kasai getting injured, but when he would come back in August, the promotion would catch some momentum with Kasai having some awesome matches at Corrigan Hall, and the crowds would pick up and do a lot better going into 2013. And then you have the Apache Army, who continued to struggle so much in Tokyo throughout 2012 that they could no longer financially run its Shinkiba first ring, and we're now having to run out of 01's dojo instead, or they're running a Shinkiba sized building in Osaka every couple months, as those shows in Osaka were still doing decent enough to continue to run, and that's what they're going to continue to do going into 2013.
Big Japan would run Corrigan Hall on January 2nd and have two title matches. Can you go over both of these matches for us?
On this show, Yoshihiro Sasaki, he's going to defend the Big Japan Strong Heavyweight title against Manabu Soya. Soya was really upset at Sasaki for proclaiming victory over All Japan when he defeated Ryota Hama back in December. And Soya would end up challenging Yoshihiro to a title match on this show. They would start off by exchanging chops with one another before Sasaki would end up putting Soya in a torture rack, with Soya escaping and hitting a flying lariat on Sasaki. Soya would then end up suplexing Sasaki off the top rope, with Sasaki getting up right away, but Soya would end up meeting him with a spear, and then hitting a Death Valley bomb with Sasaki managing to kick out, but then Soya would end up hitting a lariat on Sasaki to get the win. This was not much of a match, which is a shame that Sasaki's run would end on such a nothing match after having several really good matches and the run just ending just like that. And then their main event's going to be Abdullah Kobayashi defending the Big Japan Deathmatch title against Shuji Ishikawa. This is going to be a fluorescent light tubes, glass board, Kinzon, thumbtacks deathmatch. Kobayashi, he's fresh off winning the Fighting Spirit Award for 2012 from Tokyo Sports. I talked about it last episode, how Big Japan really gave Kobayashi a run here with the title in a bunch of main events to try and have as many great matches as possible, and some were great, some weren't, and so this was the goal, and Kobayashi was able to accomplish that goal by winning the Fighting Spirit Award. So this match would start with Ishikawa just throwing Kobayashi into the light tube set up in the ropes, head first into them, and then Ishikawa would put Kobayashi in an abdominal stretch and just begin breaking light tubes over his head repeatedly with blood just coming out of Kobayashi. Ishikawa would then knock Kobayashi out of the ring and then dump thumbtacks on the outside, and they would begin fighting on the apron with Kobayashi kind of backdropping Ishikawa off the apron, but they would end up falling on the thumbtacks anyway. And then they would end up getting back in the ring with Ishikawa headbutting Kobayashi, but Kobayashi would come back and begin headbutting Ishikawa as well. And then Ishikawa would end up pulling out Kinzons and then deliver a funky-looking German suplex on them, and then placing one of them in Kobayashi's head, and then placing Kobayashi under a glass board set up on a stack of chairs. But Kobayashi would manage to get up as Ishikawa would end up climbing up to the top and suplexing Ishikawa off the top through the glass board, and then follow that up with an Olympic slam on the Kinzons, and then just begin tossing light tubes at Ishikawa's head, and then grab a stack of green light tubes and come off the top with them breaking over Ishikawa. And then Kobayashi would grab another huge stack of light tubes from under the ring, but Ishikawa would end up placing Kobayashi upside down in the turnbuckle, and Ishikawa would then kick the light tubes over Kobayashi, and they would begin just both headbutting one another, with Ishikawa getting the better end of it, and then knocking Kobayashi down with a knee and delivering a splash off the top for the win. So now Ishikawa is the Big Japan Deathmatch champion. This ends Kobayashi's one-year run. They accomplished what they wanted to give Kobayashi a full calendar year run with the title to try and get him an award like the Tokyo Sports Fighting Spirit Award. And so they got that now, and now they can move on. And Ishikawa now is going to have a run as Big Japan Deathmatch champion here in 2013.
Atsushi Onita would continue his feud with Tiger Mask on January 13th at Corrigan Hall. Can you go over this match and what led to this match?
So this match was set up the previous month when Onita took on Sayama at Corrigan Hall, and the match would end up being thrown out after Kuniaki Kobayashi and Masashi Ayagi, who were sitting at ringside during the match, they would end up interfering, causing the match to get thrown out. Onita had been taunting Kobayashi, and Kobayashi would end up eventually snapping and going after Onita, and then Ayagi would try to make the save for Onita, and the whole match would end up just getting thrown out, a big brawl afterwards. So this is going to be a tag match with Sayama teaming up with Kuniaki Kobayashi. They're going to go up against Onita and Ichiro Yaguchi. It would have made more sense for Ayagi to team up with Onita here based off what happened the month prior, but I guess they couldn't get him to participate, or he wasn't in good health to have a match at this point. But anyway, so Onita and Yaguchi, they're teaming up here, and Onita would end up going after and attacking Kobayashi right away and bringing him in the crowd and smashing his head against the east end wall at Corrigan Hall. But Kobayashi would end up grabbing Onita and smashing his head against the wall as well. Yaguchi and Sayama, they would brawl around ringside as Onita and Kobayashi would make it back in the ring, with Yaguchi coming in and attacking Kobayashi with a barbed wire bat. Kobayashi would then come back and deliver a spinning heel kick to Yaguchi, and then Onita would throw the barbed wire bat to Yaguchi, but Kobayashi would end up grabbing it instead and begin using it on Yaguchi, so Onita would come over and just spit red mist in Kobayashi's face, and both Onita and Yaguchi would drop Kobayashi's face onto two barbed wire bats. Onita and Yaguchi would then hit Kobayashi with the two barbed wire bats, and then Yaguchi would grab a hold of Kobayashi, and Onita would swing the barbed wire bat, but Kobayashi would move out of the way, and Onita would end up hitting Yaguchi instead, and then Sayama would come in and deliver a kick to Yaguchi, and then with the help of Sayama, Kobayashi would deliver a fisherman suplex to Yaguchi for the win. So Sayama and Kobayashi pick up the win. Afterwards, Onita would go over and spit blue mist in Sayama's eyes, and then Yaguchi would hit him with the barbed wire bat, and then Onita would go after Kobayashi, with Sayama going after Onita and Yaguchi going after Sayama. This match didn't really have any heat at all, despite there being three legends involved and it being at Corrigan Hall. Onita's team controlled the majority of the match, but because Kobayashi was so limited, and then Kobayashi gets on the offense, and the match is over pretty much right afterwards. The post-match brawl was nowhere near the electricity that they had 6 months earlier, and this feud now has produced two duds in a row. It was struggling there at the end of last year, or a month prior during the last singles match between the two, and now, you know, another dud, another clunker, and this feud is going to take a hiatus, actually, for another 6 months or so until the summer, when Onita and Sayama once again get squared up with one another.
Freedoms would run their first Shinkiba show of the year on January 20th, with Freedoms Army taking on Jun Kasai's Unchained in a 5-versus-5 elimination match. Can you go over how this show did in the main event match?
So they would announce a crowd of 153 fans for this show, which is kind of the standard of what a non-deathmatch Freedom show would do in 2012 at Shinkiba. The main event of this show is going to be Jun Kasai, Minoru Fujita, Masashi Takeda, Kenji Fukimoto, and Captain Normal, the Unchained team, taking on Takashi Sasaki, Mama Sasaki, Kamui, Hiroki, and Suzumu in a single elimination match. Pretty much it would start off with two wrestlers, and then every minute one wrestler from one side ends up coming in the ring. It would start off with Takashi Sasaki and Takeda. They would end up fighting with one another before Kenji Fukimoto would come in and double-team Takashi Sasaki until it would be time for Kamui to hit the ring, and he would end up laying both Takeda and Fukimoto out until Jun Kasai would end up hitting the ring and go for Takashi Sasaki and bring him to the outside, where they would brawl all around ringside before making it back in the ring, and then it would be time for Suzumu to even things out, and he would end up climbing up to the top and hitting a flying dropkick kick on Kasai. And then Minoru Fujita, he would come out and make the save for Kasai and deliver an exploder suplex to Suzumu, followed by one to Kamui. Hiroki would then come out next and go after Fujita, and then Captain Normal, he would be the last Unchained member to come to the ring, and he would deliver a double chokeslam to Kamui and Suzumu, and then lay Hiroki out with a kick and begin choking him when Mama Sasaki would come to the ring. And so now all 10 members of each in the match have hit the ring. Mammoth would come over and attacking everyone in Unchained before going face-to-face with Captain Normal, who would try to pick up Mammoth and try to suplex him, but Mammoth would end up getting under him and delivering a powerbomb to Captain Normal, sending him to the apron, and then knocking Abnormal off to the floor for the first elimination. And then Mammoth would go after Fukimoto, with Mammoth trying to powerbomb Fukimoto, but just completely screwing it up, and would end up falling down before actually hitting a powerbomb. And then Mammoth would end up just hitting a 29 years old on Fukimoto for another Unchained elimination to make it 5-3. freedoms, and then Hiroki, he would try to put Kasai away with a transfer ape kick, but Kasai would manage to roll him up instead and get the pin to eliminate Hiroki to stop the bleeding. So now it's 5-on-4 freedoms, when Susumu, he would come in and go after Kasai, with Kasai hitting a reverse tiger driver on him, and would end up going up for a Pearl Harbor splash, with Susumu getting his knees up, and as they would both try to toss one another over the top rope, they would both end up falling down to the floor to eliminate both of them. So both Susumu and Kasai are now out. Takashi Sasaki and Minoru Fujita, they would begin going at it, with Fujita delivering a Hurricane Rana to eliminate Takashi Sasaki, and then Kamui would then roll up Fujita shortly afterwards. This would leave Mema Sasaki and Kamui to go up against Takeda. So Takeda's the last member of the Unchained team. Mammoth and Kamui, they would try for a double Mammoth home run on Takeda, but Takeda would move out of the way, and then Takeda would end up placing Mammoth on the apron and over the top rope, and Kamui would charge at Takeda, but Takeda would move out of the way, and Kamui would end up running into Mammoth, followed by Takeda delivering a spear to knock Mammoth Sasaki off the apron for the elimination. So this is going to leave Takeda to go up against Kamui one-on-one for the match. They would face off with Kamui trying for a Pele kick, but missing it, and then Takeda would end up hitting an Olympic slam, and then finishing Kamui off with a U-style crash for the Unchained win. So Takeda gets a real rub here by defeating Kamui and Mama Sasaki, being the last member of his team to get the win for Unchained. Afterwards, they would announce the creation of the King of Freedom's world title, and would announce that starting in February at the next Shinkiba show, there's going to be a 16-man elimination tournament that's going to conclude with the finals taking place at the next Corrigan Hall show on May 2nd. And the winner is going to be the first ever King of Freedom's world champion. So after a little over 3 years, Freedom's is now establishing title belts. So this is going to be the first title belt that they establish. Finally, there's going to be an actual champion in this promotion, instead of just kind of, we're just feuding and fighting, and, you know, there's no purpose here. There's actually going to be a title belt on the line here going forward for Freedoms.
0-1 would hold a nostalgic FMW versus Wing match on February 3rd at Corrigan Hall. Can you go over this match for everybody?
So this match is entitled Remember the F. It has Atsushi Onita, Masato Tanaka, and Sabu, who's in Japan for the week, teaming up with one another to take on the wing team of Wing Kanemura, Hido, and someone going by the Leatherface gimmick. I don't know who, but he's got the Leatherface mask and the attire on. This was to promote the very heavy influence FNW Nostalgia show 5 days later at the Osaka Prefectural Gym. So that's a big show coming up, and this match is to promote it. Onita, he would end up going after Hido right away and bringing him in the crowd and smashing his head against the west sign wall at Corrigan, while Tanaka and Kanemura, they would face off in the ring, with Kanemura hitting a Hurricane Rana and then a dropkick to Tanaka. Onita and Hido, they would end up getting in the ring, and Onita would end up smashing a chair over Hito's head, while Tanaka would set Kanemura on a table, and Sabu would come off the top and deliver a flying leg drop, sending Kanemura through the table. Onita would then set up a table and pile drive Hido through it, and then Onita would take the broken table piece and smash it over Kanemura's head, while Sabu would jump off a chair to the top and deliver a dive onto Leatherface on the outside, and then Tanaka would deliver a swinging DDT to Kanemura, but Kanemura would manage to deliver a German suplex to Tanaka and throw him to Leatherface, who would hit Tanaka with a powerbomb, followed by Kanemura hitting a senton on Tanaka. Hido would then grab a barbed wire bat as Kanemura would grab a hold of Onita, with Onita moving out of the way as Hido ended up hitting Kanemura by accident with the bat, and then Onita would spit black mist in Hido's face, and then Sabu would grab a chair and hit an Arabian facebuster on Hido off the top, with Kanemura making the save, but then Sabu would end up delivering a lion salt off the middle rope and pick up the win over Hido. So this was not a great match, but nothing was really bad either. Just six wrestlers doing a style that they've mastered over the last 20 years, but they're just older and slower at this point. Everyone would shake hands and hug afterwards before Onita, Sabu, and Tanaka would pose for the cameras. So I would actually consider this a success. Like I said, nothing great, but nothing bad either. And so at this point, for everyone to be over 40 and to still be able to have a match like this and it not to be bad, I would consider it a positive.
Atsushi Onita would take on Akebono in the main event of a very heavy FMW-themed show on February 8th in Osaka. Can you talk about how this show did and all the FMW influence that was on this show?
So this show did about 3,000 in a 6,000 seat building, so about half filled, but it would be considered a success actually because most of the first level was pretty much full, whereas the second level was pretty much empty, and 01 doesn't announce crowd numbers at this point in the promotion, but like I said, it was considered a success, and they had many sponsors for this show. The theme of this show was kind of this FMW nostalgia, so a bunch of former FMW wrestlers were in the undercard matches, including this 12-man or 12-person match with Hizugatsu Oya teaming up with Hito, Freddy Krueger, Ichiro Yaguchi, Miss Mongol, and Dark Ranger, who is Naoshi Sano going under the old Ninja Hayato gimmick in FMW, and they're going to go up against Tetsuhiro Kuroda, Riki Fuji, Flying Kid Ichihara, Battle Ranger, and Masanobu Kurisu, who worked in FMW in 1990, as well as someone going under the old shooter gimmick, mass shooter gimmick in FMW. I don't know who that was. So with 12 wrestlers and practically everyone being over 40, there was not much of a good chance of this being an actual good match. The match would start with all of them, all the wrestlers fighting outside the ring when Ichihara and Battle Ranger, they would both hit acai moonsaults onto several people, with the cameras managing to miss both acai moonsaults. Kuroda and Freddy, they would begin brawling in the crowd, while Kurisu and Oya, they would end up going at it. Kuroda would end up hitting a DDT and doing his running lariat to him, while Kurisu and Oya would find themselves in the crawl brawling. Dark Ranger and Battle Ranger, they would end up getting in the ring. The Dark Ranger was actually a dark version of the Battle Ranger gimmick in FMW in 1993. Riki and Mongol, they would end up facing off, with Mongol slapping and striking Riki, and Riki tossing her into the ropes, and she would end up doing a sunset flip and pulling Ricky's pants down, but Riki would throw her into the ropes and do a hip attack on her, which would result in Mongol getting her whip and swatting Riki in the ass with it. Riki would then pick her up and deliver a kamikaze before all the wrestlers would end up getting in the ring, and Freddy Krueger would end up hitting a moonsault on the shooter to get the win. So this was actually better than expected. I wouldn't say it was good. I hate them using all these old gimmicks that were not even by the people that are originally under the mask, like Freddy Krueger, Dark Ranger, the shooter, all these gimmicks that weren't even really that popular in FMW. You know, they were only around for a couple months for the most part, and they're labeled as FMW gimmicks when I would not consider that the case, but whatever. Ryan Nakamura, who had wrestled this Bad Nurse Nakamura in FMW, she would come to the ring and give the losing team a coupon to her Osaka hotel that she works for now, which would upset Oya, who was a part of the winning team. You know, like I said, this show had a lot of sponsors, so Rai Nakamura's hotel in Osaka was a sponsor for this match. Riki then would ask for Megumi Kudo to come to the ring, and she would begin singing a song called Dreaming Now, which FMW had released on cassette of her singing back in 1992, so it was good to see Megumi Kudo here. Then the semi-main event, Shinjiro Otani and Masato Tanaka taking on Sabu and Leatherface. Tanaka and Sabu, they would end up going at it right away, as Sabu would end up just picking up a chair and throwing it at Tanaka's face, and then following that up with a dive over the top on Tanaka to the outside. Tanaka would end up sending Sabu in the crowd, while Leatherface and Otani would brawl on the other side of the building. They would end up getting back in the ring, as Otani would end up doing his face wash running kick to a bloody Sabu, but Sabu would come back with a flying drop kick on Otani. Sabu would then end up placing Tanaka on a table and delivering a flying leg drop on Tanaka, sending him through the table, and then follow that up with an Arabian facebuster, but he would end up going for another one, and Tanaka would move out of the way and tag in Otani. Sabu would end up knocking Otani down, and then placing a chair in the ring and trying to jump off the chair onto the top rope, but he would screw that up jumping off the chair, and eventually just hit the moonsault, and then tag in Leatherface, who would end up hitting a power bomb on Otani, but Tanaka would come in and hit Leatherface with a lariat, followed by a flying drop kick by Otani, and then a sliding D by Tanaka, and then Otani would finish Leatherface off with the dragon suplex for the win. Sabu afterwards would shake Otani's hand, and Sabu, Tanaka, and Otani would pose with two girls there to promote a sponsor for the show, so another match with a sponsor. And then the main event's going to be Atsushi Onita taking on Akebono in a rematch from August of 2012. This is going to be an exploding barbed wire board, and exploding barbed wire bat death match. And Akebono would get his revenge right away as they would face off, and he would end up spitting red mist in Onita's face this time right away, and then toss Onita into the exploding barbed wire, and then follow that up by throwing Onita onto the other side of the exploding barbed wire. Onita would get out of the ring to try and regroup as Akebono would just throw the referee into the barbed wire without it exploding, and then Akebono would follow Onita outside into the crowd. Akebono would charge at Onita with Onita moving out of the way, and Akebono would end up running into the turnbuckle, followed by Onita spitting red mist in Akebono's face this time. They would end up getting back in the ring, and Onita would bring Akebono with him as they would go into the exploding barbed wire together, followed by Akebono just getting up and just throwing Onita into the exploding barbed wire again, and then Akebono would deliver an elbow and then a splash with Onita managing to kick out. Akebono would then lift Onita up, and Onita would end up spitting red mist in his face and then hit the siren to turn on the explosions of the barbed wire board as Akebono would charge at Onita, and Onita would move out of the way, and Akebono would run into the exploding barbed wire board. Onita would then grab a barbed wire bat and hit Akebono in the midsection with it, causing it to explode all over Akebono's midsection, as this would be the first time a barbed wire bat had exploded, the first of many, by the way. Onita would then grab another exploding barbed wire bat and smash it over Akebono's back, and then roll Akebono over for the three count to get the win. So Onita gets his revenge in an exploding barbed wire death match against Akebono. This is the best example of Onita being a master of smoke and mirrors, as this match was perfectly executed, as there was no downtime like their previous explosion match. Onita's arm would actually get really burnt up following all the explosion spots in this match. Afterwards, Onita and Akebono, they would go up to each other and shake one another's hands out of respect. So this was going to be the end of the feud, but because this show did better than expected, they still felt like it had more legs to it, and so the Onita and Akebono feud, after a couple months, is going to restart back up, but as of now, the Onita and Akebono feud is over with Onita getting the win, but like I said, in a couple months, they're going to revisit because, wow, this was a good match, and it did well. Let's try it, and, you know, let's try and see if it works just like it did, and we'll go over here later. It did not work like this match did, but this match was a total success financially, and as far as quality goes, this was prime Onita in at this point in his career. Like I said, just perfectly executed. You know, I wouldn't say it's a great match, but it was a great match for what Onita was able to, you know, for a 50 plus year old Onita and Akebono, this was a great match.
Freedoms would begin their tournament for the King of Freedom World Championship on February 27th at Shinkiba. Can you go over all of the first round matches of the tournament?
So they would announce a crowd of 215 fans for this show, which is a good number compared to what they had done the previous month, slightly up. This was also a good sign considering the tournament matches pretty much took up this entire show and were going to be the main draw here at the next couple of Shinkiba shows. The first tournament match would be Gruken Diver taking on the Winger, and Gruken Diver was a Okinawa pro-based wrestler that had become a semi-regular in Freedoms during this time before he would end up starting up his own promotion, Ryukyu Dragon, which is based out of Okinawa, and he would end up getting the win over the Winger with a backslide to advance into the tournament. And then the next match would be Masashi Takeda taking on Aisa A. Aisa A is another Okinawa-based pro wrestler, and he would end up trying to give Takeda a diamond cutter, but Takeda would end up avoiding it and hitting an Olympic slam and then making him tap out to an arm lock, so Takeda advances to the second round of the tournament. The next match would be Brahmin Shu taking on Captain Abnormal. Abnormal would try for a choke slam, but Shu would end up spitting water in his face and then laying him out with a kick, but Abnormal would rise up like the Undertaker and then do the Undertaker rope walk and then give Shu a choke slam and try for a tombstone, but Shu would end up reversing it, and Abnormal would end up trying for another choke slam, but Shu would reverse it as well and then roll him up for the win, so Brahmin Shu advances. And then Jun Kasai would take on Kenji Fukimoto. Fukimoto would end up spitting green mist in Kasai's face right away before the bell would even ring. And then Fukimoto would take a saw and begin using it on Kasai's forehead. And then set up several chairs on the outside and suplex Kasai off the apron, sending Kasai into the chairs. Fukimoto would then suplex Kasai on the saw, but Kasai would still manage to kick out. And then Fukimoto would lay the saw on Kasai and go up to the top. But Kasai would get up and toss the saw at him and then suplex Fukimoto off the top and then hit a reverse tiger driver for the win. So Fukimoto pretty much had offense the entire match, but Kasai would end up picking up the win anyway. The next match would be Kamui taking on Brahmin Key, with Karate Brahmin appearing early on in this match and distracting Kamui, as Key would end up charging at Kamui right into Karate Brahmin in the corner. Karate Brahmin would end up climbing up to the top to try and help out his cousin, but Kamui would end up catching him and be nice enough to let him just step out of the ring and get out of the way. But eventually Karate Brahmin would try to interfere again later by charging at Kamui with Korn, with Kamui getting his boot up and then smashing the Korn over Karate Brahmin, and then Key would end up grabbing a hold of Kamui with Shu coming in the ring with a top hat and suspenders on and put the Indian ink in his mouth, and Kamui would manage to move out of the way as Shu would shoot Brahmin Key in the face with the Indian ink, and Kamui would manage to roll up Key with the Kamui clutch for the win. So Kamui ends up advancing to the second round, and then Tatsuhiro Takeiwa would take on Keizo Masuda. This would be a really shitty strong style match, with the ending seeing Takeiwa hitting a Death Valley Bomb on Masuda for the win. So Takeiwa advances. Then Mama Sasaki would take on Minoru Fujita, with Fujita jumping Mammoth as he would come to the ring, and Fujita would then try to put Mammoth away early on with roll-ups and then a Hurricane Rana and then go after Mammoth's knee. Mammoth would manage to fight back with a choke slam off the top and then the running powerbomb off the ramp spot, sending Fujita back in the ring. Mammoth would try for 29 years old then, but Fujita would end up rolling him up out of nowhere to get the win. So Fujita picks up the win here, eliminates Mammoth from the tournament early on. Mammoth is in this awkward situation with the promotion, as he has seniority and is at the level of the likes of Takashi Sasaki, so they rarely want him to job, but don't want him beating the top guys in the promotion either. So as a result, Mammoth, for 7 years since the title has been created, has never even gotten a title shot here, because they would rather just him hang out in the upper mid card than actually win the title and then have to eventually lose it to someone. So this match would turn out to be the only time that Mammoth would even get a shot at the King of Freedom's title in the last 7 years since the title belt has been created. And then the main event's going to be Takashi Sasaki taking on Hiroki. Takashi would focus on Hiroki's knee after giving him a dragon screw, which would seem to mess up Hiroki's knee. So Takashi is just focusing on the knee for the majority of the match, giving him dragon screws. And although Hiroki would try to roll up Takashi, Hiroki would pretty much be on the defensive the majority of the match until Takashi would make him tap out to the sharpshooter. So Takashi Sasaki advances. So now that leaves 8 people left going into the second round in the March Shinkiba show, and overall this show wasn't really any good, with 8 tournament matches. None of the matches really got any time to establish themselves, and so it was just kind of, hey, well, let's just get these first round matches over with so we can focus on the second and third and finals matches going forward. So like I said, overall a disappointing show.
Big Japan would have 2 special matches on March 1st at Corrigan Hall, one being a strong title match and one being the main event match between Jun Kasai and Jackie Numazawa. Can you go over these 2 matches for everybody?
So this show would have Manabu Soya defending the Big Japan Strong Heavyweight title against Daisuke Sekimoto. They would start off running into one another, with Soya getting the better end of it and knocking Sekimoto out of the ring. Soya would then throw Sekimoto into the crowd and take him into the bleachers and smash his head against the east side of Corrigan Hall. They would get back in the ring with Soya blocking a lariat from Sekimoto and delivering one himself, followed by a Death Valley Bomb with Sekimoto kicking out. Soya would then go for the kill with the lariat, but Sekimoto would catch him and roll him up with a Cobra Twist for the win. So Sekimoto wins the title that was made for him 10 months after its creation, but another disappointing match overall, as Soya was hated by the Big Japan audience here, and the crowd was into it, but just not that much happened in the match overall. Then the main event's going to be Jun Kasai taking on Jackie Numazawa in a no-canvas razor crossboard death match. Kasai would end up sending Numazawa early on into the razor board, with blood just dripping down Numazawa's forehead right away. Kasai would then set up the other razor crossboard on a stack of chairs and try to hit a reverse tiger driver on Numazawa, but Numazawa would reverse it and lift Kasai up on the turnbuckle and hit a powerbomb, sending Kasai into the razor crossboard. Numazawa would then send Kasai headfirst into both razor crossboards and then hit a Death Valley Bomb, but he would end up going up to the top, and Kasai would end up meeting him with the suplex off the top onto the razor crossboard, with Numazawa no-selling it, but Kasai would just end up hitting a reverse tiger driver on Numazawa on the razor crossboard and then a difficult-looking German suplex on the no-canvas ring. Kasai would then end up hitting a Pearl Harbor splash and begin taking the board out of the ring and hit a Tiger Driver through the hole, kind of, as it would look like they both fell into the hole too early to make it look successful-looking. Numazawa would then come out of the hole with a box of light tubes and smash them over Kasai's head, and then lift Kasai up and send him through the hole into the ring, or underneath the ring. They would end up getting back in the ring, and Numazawa would end up hitting a pile driver, but as he would end up going to pick Kasai up, he would be lifted up by Kasai and pushed into the Razor Crossboard, and then Kasai would hit a reverse Tiger Driver, and then sandwich Numazawa in the corner between both Razor Crossboards, and then finish Numazawa off with a Murder Ride Bomb for the win. Afterwards, Kasai and Numazawa, they would embrace once again, just like they did the previous time they wrestled a singles match, but this would actually be their final singles match against one another. This was a good match overall, but Numazawa's limited ability with his body breaking down at this point, obviously is going to hurt the match a little bit, but they did an overall good job of hiding it with all the gimmicks used in this match. So overall, a success and a good match overall.
Freedoms would then run their second round matches of the tournament for the King of Freedom World Championship on March 14th at Shinkiba. Can you go over the tournament matches on the show?
So they would announce a crowd of 182 fans for this show, so just kind of back to the standard of what Freedoms typically does at Shinkiba. So on this show, Keizo Masuda and the Winger would team up to take on Kenji Fukimoto and Captain Abnormal, and the finish would see Fukimoto accidentally hitting Abnormal over the head with the chair, and the Winger would roll Abnormal up for the pin. Afterwards, Fukimoto would be really upset at Abnormal for losing, even though Fukimoto cost him the match by hitting him over the head with the chair, and Fukimoto would begin attacking Abnormal when Karate Brahmin would come to the ring and try and make the save. Fukimoto would end up going after Karate Brahmin, but Abnormal would grab Fukimoto and chokeslam him, as it would look like Abnormal and Karate Brahmin had formed an alliance, as Karate Brahmin would give Abnormal a stuffed teddy bear that Abnormal would take and walk off with. So that takes us to the next match, where the Great Kajika would team up with Gabe Chichon, who I talked about last episode. He was this masked wrestler portraying an old man, so he has this cane and would walk really slowly, and then all of a sudden the flip will switch and he becomes this high-flying wrestler that can do all these moves at a million miles per hour. They're going to team up to take on the Brahmin brothers, and in this match, Karate Brahmin, he would end up coming to the ring to try and interfere with his corn, but Kajika would grab the corn from him and hit him over the head with it, and then take Karate Brahmin outside the ring and begin choking him to the back, as they would end up coming back with Captain Normal having his hand around Great Kajika's throat and would bring him back in the ring and choking him, as Gabe would jump off the top to try and make the save, but Abnormal would grab him and chokeslam him, and then Key would grab a hold of Karate Brahmin as Karate would end up going for the Indian Ink, but of course Kajika would move out of the way and Karate would end up spitting the Indian Ink in Key's face instead, and then Kajika would end up going after Karate while Shu would wipe the Indian Ink on his face and do the twin magic spot, as Key would roll out and Shu would throw powder in Kajika's face and lay him out with the zombie kick for the win. And then just two matches later, Brahmin Shu, he's going to face off against Tetsuhiro Takeiwa in the second round of the tournament for the King of Freedoms title. And he still has Indian Ink all over his face from earlier. Key would end up coming in to try and interfere, and Takeiwa would end up knocking them both down. But Karate Brahmin, he would try to interfere. He has his face covered in ink as well from earlier. And he would go up to the top, but Takeiwa would notice him and just let him out of the ring. No harm, no foul. But as he's doing that, Shu would end up throwing powder in his face and rolling Takeiwa up with a schoolboy, but Takeiwa would end up kicking out. Then Key would try to interfere, throwing powder at Takeiwa, but he would end up accidentally hitting Shu with the powder instead, and then Takeiwa would roll Shu up with a backslide for the win, so Takeiwa advances to the semifinals. Then the next tournament match is going to be Takashi Sasaki taking on Gurukin Diver. Gurukin Diver would end up going up to the top rope and diving off of it, but Takashi would end up getting his knees up and then hitting Gurukin with a Michinoku Driver 2, followed by a DJ's for the win, so Takashi advances to the semifinals. Then the next tournament match is going to be Jun Kasai taking on Minoru Fujita. They would start off by fighting on the ramp of Shinkiba, with Fujita going after Kasai's injured knee and then leaving him to be counted out of the ring, but Kasai would manage to jump back in the ring at the last second, and then Fujita would put Kasai in an ankle lock, with Kasai grabbing the rope for a break, and then they would begin striking one another, with Fujita hitting repeated tombstone pile drivers on Kasai, but Kasai would manage to get up before Fujita could even make a cover on him, and then Fujita would try again, and Kasai would begin punching Fujita before picking him up and hitting his own tombstone piledriver with Fujita managing to kick out. They would begin exchanging lariats with Fujita falling down to his knees but then grabbing Kasai and rolling him up with the schoolboy for the win. So Minoru Fujita gets the upset win over Jun Kasai. Afterwards, Jun Kasai, he would end up calling out Atsushi Onita, stating that he wanted to have a match against the King of Death Matches in Onita to prove that he was the new king. And this is going to set up Onita eventually appearing in Freedoms. And then the main event, the last tournament match of the show, is going to be Masashi Takeda taking on Kamui. Takeda would rush after Kamui right away and just throw him in the crowd. And then Takeda would end up grabbing a ladder and just tossing it at Kamui. Kamui would come back by hitting a running dropkick to Takeda and then bringing him in the ring. And Kamui would end up going for a moonsault, but Takeda would move out of the way and then deliver a leg drop, sending Kamui to fall against the ladder. Takeda would then place a chair over Kamui and go up to the top, but Kamui would end up getting up and tossing the chair at Takeda and then smashing a chair over his head. And then he would end up going up to the top, but be met by Takeda, delivering a uranage off the top rope on a stack of chairs. Takeda would then pick up Kamui from his legs and lift him up for a suplex and then a running knee, but Kamui would still manage to kick out. Takeda would then try for a powerbomb on a stack of chairs, but Kamui would manage to escape and deliver a Pele kick. And then Kamui would end up grabbing the ladder and climbing up to the top, but Takeda would end up charging at it, causing Kamui to fall off the top of the ladder to the outside of the ring in a really cool spot. Takeda would then place the ladder against two chairs and the apron and try to powerbomb Kamui, but Kamui would lift Takeda and deliver a drop to Takeda's head up against the ladder off the apron. Kamui would then grab a chain and wrap it around Takeda's neck, but Takeda would pull Kamui towards him as he would go for a swing. Kamui would duck it and roll Kamui up for the Kamui clutch for the win. This was a big singles win for Kamui, just like the Fujita win over Kasai earlier. Tournament matches in Japan cause results that you would not see otherwise to line up the next matches correctly. So they needed to get Kasai out. They needed to get, you know, Mama Sasaki out on the earlier. They needed to get Masashi Takeda out. So, you know, you're going to see upsets like this that you would not see otherwise in a regular standard match in Japan.
The Apache Army would run their first show in Osaka on March 24th. Can you go over the top matches on this show and how Kanemura is looking these days?
So on this show, Tetsuhiro Kuroda, he's going to defend the WEW title against Yohei. Yohei is a very talented worker that came through the Dragon Gate system, but he had gotten fired in Dragon Gate for abusing the pet monkey that was living in the dojo with all the wrestlers. And as a result, he had announced his retirement, and then after a couple years, decided he wanted to get back in the business and would begin working independent promotions like the Apache Army until he would find a home in NOAH. In this match, Yohei, he would end up knocking Kuroda out of the ring and then delivering a dive over the top onto him. Yohei would get himself over during this match that the entire crowd would be chanting for him, as he would end up nailing a flying drop kick and then a corkscrew press. He would end up going for another corkscrew press, but Kuroda would move out of the way and hit a lariat on him and then a German suplex, with Yohei getting right up and laying Kuroda out with the super kick, as fans are passionately screaming for Yohei here. But Kuroda would end up coming back with a lariat and then a dragon suplex and then finishing Yohei off with a lariat for the win. So even though Kuroda got the win and was the Apache Army wrestler, Yohei was the star here. The fans were so behind him because of his look, because of his talent. He got himself over and became the face, and, you know, matches like this is the reason why Yohei would end up finding a job with a major promotion like NOAH down the road. And then Kentaro Kanemura, Hiroki, and their special tag partner Yoshihaki Fujiwara, they would end up going up against the Apache Demolition team of Tomohiko Hashimoto, Shoshi Ichimaya, and Kinshiro Arai. The Apache Demolition team, they would go after the Apache Army team right away, with all six wrestlers brawling around ringside. Fujiwara and Hashimoto, they would get in the ring and go at it, as Hiroki would set Ichimaya on a table, and Kanemura would climb up to the second level of the building and do a dive, sending Ichimaya through the table. Hashimoto would end up grabbing Hiroki, as Hazard would get in the ring and set a firecracker off in his face, and then Fujiwara would end up coming in and begin delivering headbutts to everybody until Arai would end up hitting him low, forcing Fujiwara to make the tag to Kanemura, who would look so much better in this match than he did the previous year while dealing with injuries, as he would deliver a Hurricane Rana to Arai and then elbows to Ichimaya, followed by a Senton Splash to Ichimaya to get the win. So the Apache Army get the win. Like I said, Kanemura looks so much better here than he did the previous year dealing with injuries, and, you know, now Kanemura looks like he used to a couple years back before he dealt with all these serious injuries, and he looks like a wrestler that can go. And, you know, this match wasn't great or anything like that, but again, it just kind of showed that Kanemura still has something left in the tank.
Freedoms would hold the semifinals of the King of Freedom World Championship Tournament on April 3rd in Shinkiba. Can you talk about the tournament matches and what ended up happening during intermission of this show?
So they would announce a crowd of 215 fans, so another good number overall from what Freedoms is used to at Shinkiba. And on this show, the Great Kajiko team up with Gabe Chichon, and they're going to take on Brahmin Shu, Brahmin Key, Karate Brahmin, and Captain Normal. This match would start with everyone outside the ring besides Gabe, who would end up walking very slowly with his cane, looking like he was going to dive onto everyone, but then everyone would move to the other side of the ring before Gabe could get to them, and then Karate Brahmin would come in the ring and begin walking with his corn as a cane, and then the Brahmin brothers would grab that corn and begin sexually assaulting the Great Kajiko with it, and then Karate Brahmin would grab a hold of Gabe when Grabe would end up breaking free, and he and Kajika would go to hit a chokeslam on Karate when the Brahmin brothers would make the save by hitting Kajika with a street sign and then hitting him with a zombie kick to get the win over Great Kajika. So the Brahmin brother team get the win, and afterwards they begin laying Great Kajika out when Tajiri would rush to the ring. This is Tajiri's first time appearing in Freedom since June 2010, as Tajiri would make the save. Afterwards, Tajiri and Karate Brahmin, they would have a serious karate battle with the fans chanting for Karate, with it ending in a surprise draw as Karate would walk off with Tajiri challenging the Brahmin brothers to a match for the next Corrigan Hall show, as Freedoms is going to go all out on this May 2nd show, unlike last year, which was a complete disaster. Then during intermission, Atsushi Onita, Ichiro Yaguchi, and Hideki Osaka would hit the ring, with Jun Kasai rushing into the ring as Yaguchi and Osaka would grab Kasai, with Onita just flipping the crowd off to boos before Takeda and Fukimoto would rush to the ring to try and make the save for Kasai, but Yaguchi would use the barbed wire bat that he had on them and throw them out while cutting open Kasai. Onita would then pick up Kasai and begin slapping him and then posing to the camera with the barbed wire bat wrapped around Kasai. Onita's playing a great heel here and would end up getting on the mic and pretty much calling Kasai out for not keeping his name out of his mouth and wanting to be the king of the death match when all he does is use cheap light tubes instead of barbed wire. Kasai would get up and go after Onita, but Yaguchi would attack Kasai with the barbed wire bat, and then they would end up fighting outside Shinkiba with a six-man match being made between the Jado Army and Unchained for the next Corrigan Hall show in May. And then in the semifinals of the King of Freedom's World Title Tournament, Tetsuhiro Takeiwa would take on Minoru Fujita, and Takeiwa would try to hit Fujita with the Death Valley Bomb off the top rope, but Fujita would get away and hit a Tombstone Piledriver off the top instead, but eventually Takeiwa would pick Fujita up and deliver a powerbomb onto the turnbuckle, and then finish him off with the Death Valley Bomb to advance to the finals. And then in the main event, Takashi Sasaki would take on Kamui, and Takashi would charge at Kamui, with Kamui moving out of the way and delivering a dropkick to Takashi out of the ring, and then Kamui would deliver a dive off the apron to the outside. Kamui would then set up a board on a stack of chairs on the apron and send Takashi through the board off the apron. Kamui would then place Takashi down on the mat with a chair on top of him as he would go up to the top, but Takashi would get up and throw a chair at Kamui and then set up a ladder on a set of chairs and suplex Kamui onto the ladder. Takashi would then pick up Kamui and drop him on the ladder and then deliver a kick to Kamui's head and finish him off with a D-Jized on the ladder for the win. So this sets up Takashi Sasaki taking on Tetsuhiro Takeiwa in the main event of the upcoming Corrigan Hall show to become the very first King of Freedom's world champion.
Freedoms would then hold their big May 2nd Corrigan Hall show. Can you go over how this show did and everything that happened, including Onita wrestling in it?
So they would announce a crowd of 865 fans, which is a good number, I would say. Much better than the disaster, which was last year's 594 fans for their May 2nd show after Jun Kasai got injured. This show has Onita on the card, as well as Tajiri. And, you know, it's just kind of shows what Freedoms is at this point, where, hey, less than 1,000 fans, that's still a good number, but that's just how Freedoms is at this point, and just kind of how the independent scene in Japan is as well. So on this show, the Great Kajika is going to team up with Tajiri, Minoru Fujita, and Gabe Chichon. They're going to take on Brahmin Shu, Brahmin Key, Karate Brahmin, and Captain Normal. Karate Brahmin and Tajiri would start off by doing another karate match with each other, with Karate Brahmin looking good but missing a spinning heel kick, and then Tajiri would give him a kick, knocking him out as the fans would chant for Karate Brahmin. Gabe would end up coming in, and the Brahmin brothers would toss him into the ropes, and he would do his slow walk before picking up the pace and hitting a drop kick on both of them, and then suplexing Captain Normal. And then Tajiri would come in and deliver a kick to the head to Captain Normal, who would fall on one of the Brahmin brothers, followed by Gabe hitting a bulldog on the other Brahmin brother, as all three would be laid out onto one another, leaving just Karate Brahmin, who would just voluntarily lay on all of his teammates, and then Kajika would shove all of his partners out of the way and pin all four of them while posing to get the win. Then it's going to be Atsushi Onita's debut in Freedoms, as he's going to team up with Ichiro Yaguchi and Hideki Osaka, and they're going to take on Jun Kasai, Masashi Takeda, and Kenji Fukimoto in a barbed board death match. Onita and Kasai, they would go at it right away in the crowd, with Onita smashing Kasai's head against the east side wall of Corrigan Hall, and then grabbing a fan's beer and smashing it over Kasai's head. But Kasai would begin to fight back as the fans would be passionately cheering for Kasai here. Kasai would take Onita to the other side of Corrigan Hall and smash his head against the west sign, and then they would end up getting back on the ring where Onita would smash a chair over Takeda's head and then pile drive Takeda through a table, with Kasai making the save. Yaguchi would then throw Kasai into the barbed wire board, but Kasai would fight back and throw Osaka at a table in the corner and then smash a chair over Yaguchi's head. Onita would come in with a broken table piece and smash it over Takeda and Fukimoto's head before going over and hitting it over Kasai's head, but Kasai would no-sell it, and Onita would just spit red mist in Kasai's face immediately afterwards. Yaguchi would then try to suplex Takeda through a barbed wire board, but Takeda would end up escaping and suplexing Yaguchi through it, and then Onita would make the save with a chair shot, followed by Kasai going up to the top for a Pearl Harbor splash, but Onita would smash him over the back with a chair shot. Then Onita, with the help of Yaguchi and Hosaka, would set up the other barbed wire board, and Onita would hit Fukimoto with the powerbomb, sending him through the barbed wire board and getting the pin, so the Jado Army defeats the Unchained team here. Kasai would go after Onita right away, and all six would end up brawling afterwards, with Yaguchi giving Kasai a crappy barbed wire bat shot, knocking Kasai out of the ring. Onita would get on the mic, and the crowd would begin booing him so loudly. Freedoms might be the young nephew of FMW, that's what I've always considered them, but this fan base wants nothing to do with the father of FMW, Onita, here, especially compared to Kasai. Onita would then begin to talk shit about the fluorescent light tubes that Kasai and his company use as a nothing deathmatch item, and Unchained would end up hitting the ring and chasing the Jado Army off with light tubes, as Kasai would ask for a rematch later in the month at the next Shinkiba show, with all three smashing light tubes over their heads and then falling back on the glass as the crowd would go crazy for this. Like I said, the crowd is so passionately into Jun Kasai, especially compared to someone like Onita, who's a legend, and the fan base just sees him as just this jerk messing with Kasai. Then the main event's going to be the finals of the King of Freedom's World Championship Tournament. It's going to be Takashi Sasaki taking on Tetsuhiro Takeiwa. Takashi and Takeiwa would start by chopping one another before both would end up hitting one another with lariats. Takeiwa would end up delivering a Death Valley Bomb, followed by a running lariat with Takashi kicking out. They would end up going back to chopping one another, with Takashi holding his arms back and taking the chops before striking Takeiwa and then running at him, with Takeiwa hitting another lariat to Takashi and then heading a Death Valley Bomb off the top rope, but Takashi still managing to kick out. Takeiwa would end up picking Takashi up and hitting a fire thunder and then going up to the top, but Takashi would get up as well and suplex Takeiwa off the top rope and then place him in the sharpshooter, with Takeiwa tapping out to make Takashi Sasaki the first King of Freedom's world champion. Afterwards, Takashi would be presented with the belt, but before Takashi would be given the title belt, Jintaro's music would begin to play, and out would come Jintaro crying very loudly, as he was obviously still feeling the effects of the stroke, and he would end up going up to the ring and hugging Takashi in a very cool scene, very touching scene. Jintaro would place the belt around Takashi, and then the two would pose together. The story did fit for Takashi winning this belt, but it helped that he's the booker and he's going to want to be the first champion and get a run with it. After Sasaki would eventually lose the title, he would understand that he's not at the level of the top guys as far as the top, you know, worker or even the most over. So after he does eventually lose the title belt, he would never win the title belt again, never put himself at the top level of Freedoms any longer. So this show was a success. The Onita Kasai six-man definitely was the match that stood out. You know, it wasn't the best match in the world. There was nothing new about it, but with the amount of heat that Onita was getting here and how beloved Kasai was, even though technically Kasai's a babyface, was tremendous. This feud has so much potential here, and we'll go over here. They do continue with it, but things are going to happen that's going to result in the feud just kind of ending. But overall, right now, this feud is hot.
01 would hold a 20th anniversary show for Masada Tanaka on May 4th at Corrigan Hall. Can you go over his match as well as the FMW versus Wing match that took place on the card?
So this is actually going to be the final FMW nostalgic match that 01 is doing with all the old FMW wrestlers in a single match. They still were going to do Onita in an exploding barbed wire matches and everything, but this is the last, like, bringing in the wing guys and stuff like that. And this match is actually kind of pushed down the card to one of the earlier matches. But so in this match, it's going to be Atsushi Onita, Tetsuhiro Kuroda, and Riki Fuji, the FMW team, taking on Wing Kanemura, Hido, and Hideki Osaka. And they would start off by brawling all in the crowd, with Onita throwing Hido's head against the wall of Corrigan, while Kuroda was throwing Kanemura's head into the other side of the wall at Corrigan. And then they would end up getting back around ringside, with Kanemura slamming Kuroda off the apron through a table, and then Onita would end up grabbing a piece of that broken table and look at it and make sure he was going to use the metal portion of the table instead of the wooden portion, and he would end up smashing the metal portion of the table over Kanemura's head in a spot that, for someone like Kanemura and all the head damage that he's taken over his career, should not have taken. I actually asked Riki Fuji about this afterwards, if Kanemura was upset, and he told me that just because it was Onita with his seniority and his star power, Kanemura wasn't going to say anything out loud about it. So because it was Onita, nothing ended up happening. But this was a really shitty thing for Onita to do, to use the metal portion and smash it over Kanemura's head. Riki would end up coming in and hitting a kamikaze on Hosaka afterwards, and then Kuroda and Kanemura would square off once again, with Kanemura hitting a super power bomb on Kuroda, and then deliver a senton, but Riki would end up delivering a super kick to Hosaka, and then Kuroda would end up hitting a lariat, followed by Onita hitting a thunderfire power bomb on Hosaka, and then smash a chair over Hosaka's head, and hit another thunderfire power bomb for the win. So the FMW team gets the win over the wing team, and this was nothing much of a match at all. The only memorable thing really was Kanemura taking the wrong side of the table to the head spot. Like I said, this was buried pretty early on in the card out of the fear of it being a disaster. And this would actually become Hido's final match of his career televised. He would wrestle a couple more matches for some Onita promoted shows over the summer, but sadly he would have to retire after that due to the liver damage that he's been suffering from for the last 7-8 years or so. It's why he's taken several years off in between before coming back, and this was the final time before he could no longer physically wrestle. And these days he's really skinny as a result of this liver damage that he's been dealing with since 2006. And then the main event of the show is going to be Masato Tanaka and Shinjiro Otani, and this is going to be Masato Tanaka's 20th anniversary match. And they would go outside the ring with Tanaka throwing Otani in the crowd and then placing him on a table and climbing up to the top and delivering a dive, sending Otani through the table. They would end up getting back in the ring and begin exchanging chops to one another, with Otani getting the better end of it and then doing his face wash running kick in the corner spot. Otani would then try for a powerbomb, but Tanaka would manage to escape and hit a brainbuster on Otani, and then Tanaka would end up going for a lariat from the front, the back, and then another one from the front, knocking Otani down, and then going for the sliding D with Otani ducking it and getting up and delivering a German suplex to Tanaka, with Tanaka managing to kick out. Tanaka would then try for a diamond dust, which he hadn't tried for in a while, but Otani would manage to break away and climb up to the top and hit a hurricane rana off the top on Tanaka, but Tanaka would manage to roll him up, and then Otani would have to kick out at two. Otani would then deliver a German suplex off the turnbuckle and then hit a flying drop kick, hitting Tanaka from the back, and then a spiral bomb with Tanaka still kicking out. They would both get up and begin exchanging strikes with one another, with Tanaka getting the better end of it and hitting a sliding D, but Otani would still kick out of Tanaka's move, and then Otani would fight back and with strikes and hit a dragon suplex and then another spiral bomb for the win. This was a good match, especially considering both wrestlers are in their 40s at this point, but it seemed like a WWE booking decision to have the person's big anniversary type match and him coming away with the loss. So, like I said, good match overall, but I question the booking decision. But I guess at the end of the day, Otani's the one in charge, and that's all that matters.
Big Japan would hold their Yokohama Bunka Gym show on May 5th. Can you talk about the three title matches on this show?
So on this show, Yuko Miyamoto and Isami Kadaka, they're going to defend the Big Japan Tag Team titles against Kenkaro Hoshino and Masato Inaba. This is going to be an Iron Cage Fluorescent Light Tubes death match. Hoshino and Inaba, they would jump Miyamoto and Kadaka right away and begin brawling on the outside. They would fight back in the ring, and Miyamoto would begin breaking light tubes over Hoshino before tagging in Kadaka, who would proceed to break more light tubes over Hoshino's head. Inaba would end up coming in, and both he and Hoshino would take Kadaka and throw him into the Iron Cage breaking light tubes that were placed inside of it. Hoshino would then take Miyamoto and throw him into the cage, but Miyamoto would come back with a lariat and tag in Kodaka, with both Kodaka and Inaba going up to the top of the iron cage, followed by Miyamoto climbing it up as well, as both Miyamoto and Kodaka would deliver a superplex off the iron cage on Inaba. Hoshino would then come in, but Miyamoto would hit a handspring elbow on him, followed by Kodaka delivering a double knee drop on Hoshino for the win. This was nothing compared to what they were doing a couple years ago, but Hoshino and Inaba are not at the level of their opponents from a couple years ago as well, and they don't have to prove themselves any longer, especially for a non-main event tag match. And then Daisuke Sekimoto would defend the Big Japan Strong Heavyweight title against Takao Amore. Amore would end up going for a lariat, but Sekimoto would duck it and roll him up with a ground cobra twist with Amore kicking out. But then Sekimoto would follow that up with a lariat and then a German suplex for the win. Another nothing match. Sekimoto is a great worker, but these All Japan guys are just not at the level of someone like Sekimoto, and the crowd really just doesn't care, especially in Yokohama. And then Shuji Ishikawa, he defends the Big Japan Deathmatch title against Ryuji Ito in the main event. They had revealed the new Big Japan light tube deathmatch title here, replacing the long time used spider net Big Japan deathmatch title, which I still prefer. This is going to be a light tube glass board Kinzon deathmatch, and they would start outside the ring with hitting each other over the head with light tubes before Ito would end up throwing Ishikawa in the crowd, and then Ito would end up getting on the apron, and as Ishikawa would come over, Ito would toss him a stack of light tubes with Ishikawa catching them, and then Ito would kick them across Ishikawa's chest. They would end up getting back in the ring, and Ishikawa would grab Ito and begin headbutting him, and then just toss him into the first glass board in the corner. Ishikawa would then just begin breaking light tubes over Ito's head before dropping Kinzons in the ring and trying to powerbomb Ito onto them, but Ito would flip Ishikawa over onto the Kinzons, but then Ishikawa would come back and slam Ito on the Kinzons. Ishikawa would then try to splash Ito, but Ito would move out of the way, and then Ito would try to drop an elbow, but Ishikawa would move out of the way, so they're both getting to feel the pain of the Kinzons here, and then Ito would get up and hit a moonsault onto Ishikawa, but he would end up shooting himself too far and getting a good deal of the Kinzons as a result, and then Ishikawa would deliver a knee and then a backdrop into a Kinzon, but Ito would follow that up by hitting a German on the Kinzons before Ito would grab a chair and then throw it at Ishikawa's head. They would end up taking turns punching Kinzons in one another's head, and then Ito would try for a dragon splash, but Ishikawa would then end up getting his knees up and then hitting a fire thunder on the Kinzons, and then hit a splash mountain powerbomb on the Kinzons, and then place the other glass board over a stack of chairs over Ito's body and go up to the top rope, but Ito would get up and climb up to the top and suplex Ishikawa off the top rope, sending him through the other glass board, and then Ito would place a stack of light tubes over Ishikawa and hit a dragon splash with Ishikawa still kicking out. Ito would then bring in another large stack of light tubes and place them over Ishikawa, with Ito climbing up to the top, but Ishikawa would end up getting up and placing Ito in the Tree of Woe, and then placing the light tubes over Ito and just kicking them right into him, and then hit another Splash Mountain Powerbomb with Ito kicking out one more time, and then Ishikawa would come back with another Splash Mountain Powerbomb for the win. This was a good match overall. Ishikawa is a better worker and more mobile than Kobayashi, but this match had no heat at all. When it doesn't seem like anyone cares that you're both killing one another, it's not a good look, but they are getting Ishikawa over as this unstoppable monster here. So like I said, good match, just the crowd in Yokohama just did not care about it at all, and it's a bad look when, hey, they are literally going through Kinzons, light tubes, glass boards, and it is not getting any reaction from anyone in the crowd of this big building.
Freedoms would come back to Shinkiba on May 30th. Can you talk about the two top matches, including the Onita versus Jun Kasai six-man main event match?
So they would announce a crowd of 258 fans, which is up a good amount from the previous couple shows, and I would have to say it's due to the Onita Kasai feud, which is main eventing this show. The semi-main event of the show, though, is going to be a hardcore match between Takashi Sasaki and Suzumu. Suzumu, he's going to go from being a regular with Freedoms to an actual contracted employee, and so he's going to take on the boss here, and he would end up jumping Takashi right away and delivering a dive to him on the outside, and then they would end up getting back in the ring with Suzumu placing Takashi on a ladder, and then a stack stack of chairs on top of him and delivering a splash off the middle of the top rope. Susumu would then climb up the ladder, but Takashi would end up grabbing the ladder and throwing it at Susumu, and then setting up all the chairs on top of one another and suplexing Susumu off the ladder, and then follow that up with a lariat and then a Michinoku driver on the stack of chairs for the win. So Takashi Sasaki gets the win over Susumu. Like I said, Susumu is now going to be an actual contracted wrestler with Freedoms. Afterwards, the Brahmin Brothers, they would come out and challenge Takashi Sasaki to a three-way title match on the next show, with Takashi accepting. And then in the main event, it's going to be Atsushi Onita, Ichiro Yaguchi, and Hideki Osaka taking on Jun Kasai, Masashi Takeda, and Kenji Fukimoto in another barbed wire board death match. They would start off all brawling around the building, with Osaka and Takeda doing a dueling chair spot with one another, with Osaka winning it, but Takeda would end up just nailing Osaka with a spear, as Onita and Kasai would end up brawling all over the bleachers in Shinkiba. They would end up getting back in the ring with Kasai bloody, and Onita would hit him with a weapon before Onita and Yaguchi would throw Kasai into one of the barbed wire boards. Yaguchi and Osaka would then work on Kasai in the ring, as Onita would pile drive Fukimoto on the Shinkiba ramp. Osaka would then take a barbed wire bat and swing at Kasai, with Yaguchi holding him, but of course Kasai would move out of the way, and Osaka would end up hitting Yaguchi with it instead, as Takeda would then place the other barbed wire board, with both Fukimoto and Takeda running into the barbed wire board across Yaguchi's body. Kasai would then end up going up to the top for a Pearl Harbor splash, but again, Onita would meet him with a chair shot to the back, and then spit blue mist in Kasai's face. They would end up setting up the barbed wire board on a stack of chairs, as Onita would look to powerbomb Kasai through it to get another win, but Takeda and Fukimoto would manage to make the save for Kasai. Yaguchi then would hand Osaka a stack of light tubes and look to finish Kasai off with his own weapon, when Minoru Fujita would jump in the ring and deliver a kick to Osaka before running off. That would allow Kasai to hit Osaka with a reverse tiger driver and then a Pearl Harbor splash with the barbed wire board over Osaka to get the win, and then Kasai would grab a stack of light tubes immediately and smash the light tubes over Onita's head. Yaguchi would then attack Kasai with the barbed wire board afterwards, as Onita would get on the mic and challenge Kasai to an 8-man match next month, with Onita promising a new member of the Jado Army to be revealed to go up against Unchained. So, like I said, this feud is hot right now. There's some believability. People believe Kasai and Onita hate each other. They believe Onita, and I think this really is the case, where, hey, Onita thinks these light tubes are a piece of shit and they don't really hurt. Whereas, you know, barbed wire is the real deathmatch item. But hey, this is Kasai's promotion. It's his home promotion. They use the light tubes. So the light tubes are, you know, considered the top weapon over what Onita does. So this feud really is clicking, because there's the believability of, hey, these guys hate each other and they really think that their weapons are the best weapons as far as death matches go. And it's interesting to see, this is the first time Onita's really being a heel and being a great heel in a death match promotion.
666 would hold an FMW nostalgic match on their June 6th show at Shinkiba. Can you go over this match?
So on this show, Goemon and Onryo, they're going to team up for the first time in about 3 years, and it's actually Goemon's first match in about 3 years as well. They're going to take on the former FMW team of Tetsuhiro Kuroda and Hideki Osaka, and in this match, Onryo would end up hitting a Hurricane Rana on Kuroda, but Osaka would come over and hit a last ride powerbomb to Onryo, and then Kuroda would deliver a kick to Goemon and roll him up with the Samson Clutch for the win. So just based off the highlights, it didn't seem like anything of a match, but it's a cool thing that 666 is using FMW nostalgia here. You know, FMW has been closed down for over a decade at this point, but you have independent promotions like Six who are going to continue to do more FMW-based matches on their cards, as well as you have the whole 01 using FMW nostalgia as well to make money. So it's just a cool fact here that FMW just still is, you know, viable, even though it's been dead for over 10 years now.
Freedoms would have their next Shinkiba show take place on June 27th. Can you go over the top matches of the show for everybody and how these shows are doing with the Onita versus Jun Kasai feud going on?
So they would announce a crowd of 267 fans, so another high number for Shinkiba. Onita and Kasai, this feud is a draw right now. And, you know, I mentioned a little while ago how, hey, there's believability that they don't like each other. And, you know, to me, I was at this show. I was in Japan, so I went to this show. And, you know, I really was psyched up for this. It was, you know, FMW versus Freedoms to me. And that was something I was really looking forward to. So the opening match is going to be Mama Sasaki, Keizo Masuda, and the Winger taking on Santoru Sugawara, Yusaku Ito, and Daisuke Masaaka. So it's going to be veterans versus the young guys. I talked about Masaaka a couple episodes ago. He was this Osaka independent wrestler that had a lot of talent, and he was just looking to make a name of himself and, you know, get in a bigger promotion. He was always working these small little indies in Osaka, so no one really knew about him. Well, now he's gotten kind of a spot with Freedom, says he's going to become a regular here, and he would end up getting some offense in this match by hitting an acai moonsault onto both Matsuda and the winger, but Mammoth would be left alone eventually with all three of the younger wrestlers and just finish Yusaku Ito off with a lariat and then a powerbomb for the win. And then Takashi Sasaki, he would take on Brahmin Shu and Brahmin Key in a three-way for the King of Freedom world title. Brahmin Shu and Key would both spit water on the belt while Jintaro was trying to show the belt off before the match, and then they would all pose together for a picture with the belt, with the Brahmin brothers just spitting water in the air the whole time. The Brahmin brothers, they would start fighting with one another right from the start as Takashi would just watch on and then try to break it up, which would cause them to just both throw Takashi out of the ring and begin going at it with one another again, striking each other. Eventually, Takashi would get back in the ring and once again try and break it up between the two as he would end up trying to suplex Key, and Shu would come over and help Takashi take Key out as Brahmin Shu and Takashi would high-five one another as Takashi and Shu now are working together to take on Key. Takashi would then grab a hold of Key as Shu would grab a powder, but instead of throwing it in Key's face, he would throw it in Takashi's face as the Brahmin brothers would reunite, so the Takashi Sasaki Brahmin Shu alliance did not last long. They would end up going after Takashi outside the ring by spitting water in his face and then hitting him with a water bottle as Shu would spin a water bucket around until it would end up getting wrapped around his neck. Takashi and Shu would then begin fighting over that water bucket, with Takashi dumping the water bucket over Shu's head, which would be right in front of me, so water is getting everywhere, got all over me. Shu and Key would then take a trash can and dump it over Takashi's head, and they would end up getting back in the ring with Takashi fighting back and delivering a clothesline to both of them, and then placing one of the Brahmin brothers in a sharpshooter, with the other one having to make the save by hitting Takashi with a street sign. The Brahmins then would end up going up to the top and delivering a double stomp, and then try to both pin Takashi at the same time, but he would still manage to kick out, and then they would go for the Indian Ink, but Takashi would cover both their mouths, and then deliver a kick to them, and Takashi would charge at them, but they would both end up just spitting the Indian Ink in Takashi's face and then rolling him up with the Nobody's Perfect roll-up, with Takashi still managing to kick out, which got a really good pop from the crowd. Jintaro then would end up getting on the apron, and both Brahmin brothers would end up grabbing him, bringing him in the ring as they would go to spit Indian Ink in his face, but Jintaro would move out of the way, and Shu would accidentally end up spitting it in Key's face. Takashi then would end up making this mistake of putting ink in Jintaro's mouth so that he could spit it at them, but Jintaro would barely manage to spit any of it out, and meaning he swallowed a good majority of this Indian Ink, as Takashi would end up hitting a powerbomb on Brahmin Shu, and then a Michinoku Driver 2 on Key, and then put them both in the sharpshooter at the same time, as they would both tap out for the Takashi Sasaki win. This was a really fun and creative comedy match. Afterwards, Jintaro would hand Takashi the belt, and overall, like I said, this was a really good match, and other than Jintaro just screwing up and accidentally swallowing a whole bunch of Indian Ink, which was not pretty. And then the main event's going to be Jun Kasai, Masashi Takeda, Minoru Fujita, and Kenji Fukimoto taking on Atsushi Onita, Ichiro Yaguchi, Hideki Osaka, and a mystery partner. Yaguchi would get on the mic right away and announce that the newest member of the Jado Army is... And then Mama Sasaki's music would begin to play as Mama Sasaki would come to the ring in an Atsushi Onita t-shirt. They would start the match by brawling all around ringside as Onita would end up grabbing Fukimoto and taking him up the bleachers of Shinkiba. Mammoth and Kasai would begin fighting all around ringside, with Mammoth laying Kasai out with headbutts and then using a barbed wire bat to cut Kasai up. Eventually, all four members of the Jado Army would end up getting in the ring with Takeda, and Mammoth would end up hitting a Mammoth home run on Takeda, with Unchained quickly rushing to the ring to try and make the save for Takeda. Yaguchi would then throw Takeda in the ropes, but Takeda would come back with a spear on Yaguchi. Kasai would then come in and grab the barbed wire bat and hit Yaguchi with it, but Mammoth would come in and hit Kasai with the lariat, followed by Yaguchi hitting an Olympic slam on Kasai, and then Onita would come in at the same time as Fukimoto and hit him over the head with the chair, and then hit a Thunderfire powerbomb with Unchained again, making the save. Hosaka would then go for a powerbomb to Kasai, but Fujita would end up laying him out with a kick to the head, and then Takeda would come in and hit a slam on Hosaka, followed by Kasai hitting a Pearl Harbor splash on him, with Osaka still managing to kick out. Onita would then come in and go up against Kasai, with Takeda sliding in some light tubes to Kasai, but just as he was about to hit Onita over the head with the light tubes, Onita would end up spitting red mist in Kasai's face, and then Mammoth would come in and hit a powerbomb to Kasai, and then hit a 29 years old on those light tubes that were brought in the ring for the win. So Mammoth Sasaki ends up getting the win for the Jado Army over Kasai. This was an awesome match live, but it did not translate that well on video. The heat live and just everyone brawling all over the place was great, but on video it just comes off as a short match with heat not seeming as electric as in person. Mammoth afterwards would begin waving the Onita flag as Kamui would end up hitting the ring and hitting a flying dropkick to Mammoth, as Takashi Sasaki would also hit the ring, upset over Mammoth leaving the Freedoms group for Onita's group, as the Onita group would end up just heading out. Kasai and Takashi Sasaki would then get in the ring and face each other off as begin shoving one another, when Kamui ended up getting on the mic and asking for Freedoms and Unchained to work together to take out the real enemy, the Jado Army. This was officially Kasai's face turn after a year, although he had been pretty much a babyface anyway since making his comeback from his injury back in August 2012. Kasai and Takashi would agree to work together, although they would continue to stay as two separate groups, and as Unchained still is a group to this day. They would show Takashi and Kasai going into the locker room to confront Onita and Mammoth afterwards for Mammoth leaving Freedoms. This was an awesome angle and very heated, as it had this inter-promotional feel to it, and with the addedness of Mammoth joining the group, leaving Freedoms. Sadly, the follow-up on this afterwards would not be much, as this feud ends up getting put on pause to do the deathmatch tournament for the next couple months, and would only end up doing two shows in September, and pretty much afterwards the feud is over, but we'll go over everything here in a little while.
Masashi Takeda would challenge for the Big Japan Deathmatch title on June 30th at Corrigan Hall. Can you go over everything that happened in this main event match?
Yeah, so this is going to be a fluorescent light tubes glassboard death match. Before the match, Abdullah Kobayashi, he would come to the ring. He's out of action due to an illness, and so he's showing the belt to the fans before the match. So he's kind of doing the Jintaro role in the meantime while he's out. So the match would start with Ishikawa placing a table and light tubes on it outside the ring and trying to suplex Takeda off the apron, but Takeda would fight back and hit a Uranagi off the apron, sending Ishikawa through the table with light tubes on it, and then throw Ishikawa in the crowd. Takeda would then take a light tube and smash it over Ishikawa's head and throw him back in the ring and toss him into the light tubes connected to the ropes, and then place a light tube over Ishikawa's back and step on it and break it over Ishikawa's back, and then Takeda would take the broken cans attached on to a board and place it across Ishikawa's back and deliver a dropkick to it. Ishikawa would then fight back and suplex Takeda on the broken cans and then take a chair and smash the broken can board over Takeda's back with the chair and then grab a light tube and swing at Takeda, but Takeda would duck it and spear Ishikawa with the light tubes breaking across his chest. Takeda would then take a stack of light tubes and lay them over Ishikawa and deliver a flip off the top, breaking the light tubes across Ishikawa once again. Takeda would then deliver an exploder to Ishikawa onto another set of light tubes, and then Takeda would take another table with the light tubes on it and try for an Olympic slam, but Ishikawa would escape and place Takeda on the top and deliver a suplex off of it, sending Takeda through the table with the light tubes on it. Ishikawa would then place Takeda in the Tree of Woe in the corner and place light tubes over him and deliver a running kick, breaking light tubes over Takeda, and follow that up with hitting a splash mountain with Takeda managing to kick out. Ishikawa would then place a glass board on a set of chairs and try to powerbomb Takeda, but Takeda would escape and come up from behind and deliver a German suplex, sending Ishikawa through the table. Takeda would then take a bucket with broken glass in it and dump it over his head and deliver another German suplex to Ishikawa, with Ishikawa kicking out. Takeda would then grab a light tube and try to spear Ishikawa with it, but he would run right into Ishikawa with the light tube not breaking, and Ishikawa would just grab that light tube and just smash it over Takeda's head. Ishikawa would then end up setting up another glass board outside the ring, getting back in the ring and picking Takeda up and delivering a splash mountain powerbomb, sending Takeda over the top rope to the outside through the glass board in one of the coolest, most awesome spots I've ever seen. I was at this show live sitting next to my friend, and when we saw that spot, we both looked at each other and went, oh my god, after seeing it. It's the old Mike Awesome Masato Tanaka spot, except this time with a glass board instead of a table. The fans are screaming for Takeda after this spot. The crowd is going crazy. Takeda's back is all bloody. Takeda manages to get right up afterwards, probably not selling it enough, but he gets up and he's smiling. He's getting back in the ring and he's just smiling as he goes up to Ishikawa and just begins striking him, but ends up grabbing Takeda by the throat like he's gonna give him a chokeslam, but instead he would end up just throwing Takeda over his head like a back suplex in another dangerous spot. But Takeda would end up catching Ishikawa's kick afterwards and then delivering an Olympic slam to him, but then Ishikawa would catch Takeda going for a knee and pick him up and deliver a fire thunder to Takeda. They would both get on their knees and begin striking one another, with Ishikawa delivering headbutts to Takeda. Ishikawa would then pick up Takeda and try for another splash mountain powerbomb, but Takeda would escape and begin choking Ishikawa, who would end up just dropping Takeda on the stack of light tubes. Ishikawa would then deliver a German suplex to Takeda and then headbutt him and then finish Takeda off with the splash mountain powerbomb for the win. This is one of the best death matches ever. One of the best matches I've ever seen live. Incredible match. One of the best matches in 2013. And it really shows how capable Ishikawa is, as most of his death matches have been lacking at this point. But Takeda really showed how good he was here, as well as what he was willing to go through. I actually saw Ishikawa after this match and got a picture with him. And then afterwards saw Takeda walking around with a limp. But sadly, I went up to him to get a picture with him, and my camera had ran out right before getting that picture with him, from taking so many pictures during this show, and especially this match. I could not end up getting a picture with him afterwards because of it. Like I said, awesome, amazing match. My personal favorite match of 2013.
Atsushi Onita would appear for Noah on July 7th at the Ariake Coliseum. Can you talk about his match on the show?
So I talked about it last episode, how Onita appeared for Noah for one of their bigger shows of the year back in December. And that's because Onita at this point is a draw. He has his own fan base. And you have Noah, a struggling promotion, running these big shows at an 8,000-seat building like the Ariake Coliseum, wanting to bring in Onita to bring in his fan base that would not be attending a Noah show otherwise. So because the December show was a success, they decide to bring back Onita for this July show. And the whole thing back in December was Onita was feuding with No Mercy, who is led by Kenta. So it was Onita versus Kenta. Well, Kenta's in the main event of this show, so Onita's not going to be able to face against Kenta in this match. The whole thing would start off with Onita appearing at Noah's June 13th Corgan Hall show to pay respects to Mitsuharu Misawa, who had passed away 4 years ago that day. Both Onita and Misawa worked All Japan back in the early 80s. This would set up Onita taking on No Mercy again, but because Kenta was in the main event, he's going to be out of this match, and Takashi Sugawara, he's going to take his spot, and Sugawara's going to team up with Yoshihiro Takayama and Jinba Hiranagi, and they're going to take on Onita, Ichiro Yaguchi, and Hideki Osaka in a barbed wire board death match. This match would start with Onita and Sugawara meeting up face-to-face with one another before Onita would just spit red mist in Sugawara's face to start the match. Onita would then take Sugawara and pile-drive him through a table, and then Onita would take Sugawara in the crowd and just walk around with him before bringing him back in the ring and throwing Sugawara in the barbed wire board. Hiranagi would end up coming in and just grabbing Onita by the dick and throwing him out of the ring, and then Hiranagi would end up climbing up to the top, but Onita would smash a broken table piece over his back and then smash it over Sugawara as well as Takayama over the head, and then they would end up setting up the barbed wire board on a stack of chairs with Onita powerbombing Hiranagi through it to get the pin and get the win for the Jado Army. This was not really much of a match, as the Onita side controlled the majority of it, and it would look to set up another Onita versus Sugawara match, but it would be another year before that would end up taking place, as Onita would not come back to Noah for another year plus.
The Apache Army would hold another show in Osaka on July 14th. Can you talk about the WEW title match as well as Kanemura's main event match on this show?
So on this show, Tetsuhiro Kuroda is going to defend the WEW title against Kenshiro Arai. Arai was a former FMW Dojo wrestler that did not make the cut, and so he was never able to make his debut in FMW and would end up joining Ultimo Dragon's Dragon Gym in Mexico instead in the late 90s. Arai would ask for Kuroda for a handshake and would get it and then hug him, followed by kicking Kuroda low. Eventually, they would end up getting in the corner where Arai would grab Kuroda's leg, and with the ref turned around, bring Kuroda's leg up to kick the ref low. The referee would then ring for the bell and disqualify Kuroda when Hasegawa would end up getting in the ring with his camera that he had been taking pictures while at ringside and show the referee to get the match restarted. Hasegawa would then take over as referee, with the referee being unable to continue with the getting kicked low. Arai would end up throwing Kuroda into Hasegawa that would result in Hashimoto and Hazard hitting the ring to attack Kuroda. Kuroda would then end up fighting them off, but Arai would end up grabbing a stick and begin cutting Kuroda with it when the original referee would come back to stop him, and Kuroda would then end up hitting a lariat on Arai with the original referee counting the three count for the wins. And then the main event's going to be Kentaro Kanemura versus Magnitude Kishiwada in a spectators throw the chair match. Apache Army's done this in the past where it's a gimmick where the fans after a certain time limit will end up just throwing all their chairs in the ring. The match would start with Kanemura hitting a Hurricane Rana on Kishiwada, and then they would begin brawling outside with Kishiwada throwing Kanemura into the chairs in the crowd. They would end up getting back in the ring, but Kanemura would come back and hit a German suplex and then go back outside where he would end up setting up Kishiwada on a table and climb up to the second level and do a dive, sending Kishiwada through the table. They would end up getting back in the ring and begin exchanging chops to one another, with Kanemura tossing Kishiwada on the mat and then delivering a kick to his back. Kanemura would then throw Kishiwada into the ropes, but he would come back with a drop kick and then a belly-to-belly suplex, and then place Kanemura in the STF when the countdown would begin for the fans to throw the chairs in the ring, causing Kishiwada to get out of dodge as all the fans would throw their chairs in the ring with Kanemura still in it, causing Kanemura to just be buried underneath all the chairs. Kishiwada would then end up getting back in the ring and suplexing Kanemura on all the chairs, and then going for a powerbomb, but Kanemura would lift him up and send him flying on the stack of chairs, and then Kanemura would go up to the top, but Kishiwada would also go up to the top and suplex Kanemura off the top on the chairs. Both Kanemura and Kishiwada would get up to their knees and begin headbutting one another, as Kanemura would pick Kishiwada up and hit a Death Valley bomb, and then climb up to the top and hit a senton splash, with Kishiwada kicking out and then smashing a chair over Kanemura's head, and then diving off the top with Kanemura still managing to kick out. Kishiwada then would go for a powerbomb, but Kanemura would flip him over on the set of chairs, and then get a table and put Kishiwada on it and go up to the top. But Kishiwada would go up to the top as well and grab Kanemura and powerbomb him off the top through the table, and then smash him over the head with the broken table. But Kanemura would fight back and hit another Death Valley bomb on a stack of chairs, and then bury Kishiwada under the chairs and hit two sentons for the win. This was a great match. It showed that Kanemura could still go despite all the injuries, and probably would turn out to be the last singles great match of Kanemura's career, as well as a great flashback to show what made Kanemura a great worker over the last 20 years. Afterwards, Kanemura and Kishiwada, they would hug and high-five out of respect to one another. Like I said, this was a great match, and it was awesome that Kanemura was able to overcome so much with his injuries to be able to put on such a quality match, and it's just a shame that not that many people ended up ever seeing it.
The Onita and Tiger Mask feud would pick back up on July 14th in Hakata. Can you talk about the match they were in and what the gimmick was for this?
Yeah, so this is going to be the first match in 6 months between Sayama and Onita, so they're picking back up this feud after a six-month hiatus, with Onita teaming up with Ichiro Yaguchi to take on Sayama and his partner, the Masked Tiger Shark. This match, they're all four of them are tied together with this string, so Onita and Sayama, they're tied together, and Tiger Shark and Yaguchi, they're tied together, but all of them are all tied together as well, so none of them can really go far from one another, and so they would end up fighting all close together until Yaguchi would end up just pulling out scissors and cutting the string, freeing everyone, and thank God, because the first couple of minutes of this match with them all tied together was ugly. Onita would then end up taking Tiger Shark and throwing him in the crowd, followed by grabbing a barbed wire bat and using it on Sayama outside the ring. And then eventually Onita and Sayama, they would get back in the ring with Onita trying to throw Sayama out. But Sayama would come right back and begin striking Onita. And then Yaguchi would come in and use the string from earlier to tie Sayama to the ropes. Onita would then end up hitting Tiger Shark with the Thunderfire Powerbomb as Sayama would manage to break free from the string and begin laying kicks to Onita and Yaguchi to make the save. Sayama would then end up hitting Onita with the Tombstone Piledriver, and then Tiger Shark would hit a headbutt and then a plancha on Onita on the outside, followed by Sayama hitting a diving body press on Yaguchi for the win. The ending sequence was good. Everything else was awful, especially the first couple of minutes of them all tied together. Onita and Yaguchi would end up attacking both the Tigers afterwards, with another singles match being made between Onita and Sayama for the following month.
Freedoms would hold a Jun Kasai 15th anniversary show on July 25th at Shinkiba. Can you talk about the top matches and how this show did?
Yeah, so because this was Jun Kasai's 15th anniversary show, they would announce a crowd of 314 fans, which is great. Again, showing how much of a draw Jun Kasai really is. On this show, Mema Sasaki, he's going to team up with Hideki Osaka, and they're going to take on Tatsuhiro Takeiwa and Minoru Fujita. This is going to be Mammoth and Hosaka's first time that the two alone would team up since losing the WEW Hardcore Tag Team titles in FMW back in 2001. Hosaka, he would end up kicking Fujita low, and then Mammoth would try to hit the Mammoth home run, but Fujita would manage to duck and throw the chair at Mammoth, with Takeiwa delivering a lariat and knocking Mammoth down. Hosaka then went into grabbing Fujita's leg, setting up both Mammoth and Hosaka hitting Mammoth home runs on Fujita, and then Hosaka would tie Takeiwa up to the turnbuckle, and Hosaka would hit a powerbomb on Fujita, and then Mammoth would finish Fujita off with the 29 years old for the win. Then the winger would take on Toru Sugawara in a light tubes death match. This is going to be Sugawara's first death match going into the death match tournament. Sugawara would end up hitting an impressive looking Spanish fly on the winger, breaking a light tube over both of them, with Sugawara's elbow getting cut open pretty deep here. Sugawara would try delivering elbow smashes to winger, but the winger would end up rolling him up and hitting a senton splash for the win. Afterwards, Violento Jack would hit the ring, returning for the first time since the Christmas deathmatch show, and attack Sugawara and lay him out with the package pile driver, and announce that he was coming back to take out Jun Kasai, and he was entering into the deathmatch tournament next month. And then the main event's going to be Jun Kasai's 15th anniversary match, which is going to be a fluorescent light tubes glass board death match. This is one of the few times that they would do a glass board death match at Shinkiba. It's going to be Takashi Sasaki and Jun Kasai going up against Masashi Takeda and Kamui. And it would start off with Takeda and Kasai smashing light tubes over one another's head. And it would not take long before they would end up all going outside, where Takeda and Kasai would end up on the entrance ramp, with Takeda breaking the light tubes over Kasai's head. And then the two would begin striking one another, with Kasai pile driving Takeda on the ramp. Kamui would then throw Kasai in the ring and then charge at him, but Kasai would move out of the way, and Kamui would just stop himself short of going into the glass board, when Kasai would deliver a dropkick, sending Kamui into the first glass board. Takashi and Kasai would then grab a ladder and use it to shove Kamui in the corner, before both would end up suplexing Kamui on the ladder. Takeda would then come in, but Kasai would hit a reverse tire driver on him, and then place the other glass board on a set of chairs above Takeda, as Kasai would climb up to the top, but Takeda would manage to get up and climb up to the top as well and suplex Kasai through the other glass board. Kamui would then come in and place a ladder on Takashi and hit a swanton bomb on him, injuring both of them, as Takeda would come over and deliver a suplex to Takashi, followed by an Olympic slam on the ladder, and then Kamui would climb up the ladder, but Takashi would get up as well and suplex Kamui off the ladder. Both Takashi and Kasai would then break light tubes and carve their chest up with them, as Kasai would hit Takeda with a lariat and then a Pearl Harbor splash, with Takeda kicking out, and then Kasai would end up hitting a reverse tiger driver on Takeda to get the win. So once again, Kasai has defeated Takeda going into the deathmatch tournament next month. This was a good match overall, especially for it being in Shinkiba. You don't usually see matches at this caliber in Shinkiba, but this was a special occasion, being Kasai's 15th anniversary match.
Atsushi Onita would take on Tiger Mask in a singles match once again on August 16th in Sapporo. Can you go over what happened in this match?
Yeah, so this is going to be the third singles match between Onita and Sayama in over the last year or so. And Onita would end up jumping Sayama before the bell, but Tiger Shark would end up grabbing Onita to allow Sayama to begin delivering kicks to him. Onita would then end up throwing Sayama to the ropes, but he would come back and end up being met by blue mist in the eyes spit by Onita. Yaguchi would end up coming in and holding a barbed wire bat around Sayama's throat, and Onita would grab a chair and just walk over and hit Tiger Shark in the head with it. No defense at all by Tiger Shark. Sayama would manage to throw Onita to the outside, with Tiger Shark diving at Onita and throwing him back in the ring, as Sayama would end up hitting a tombstone piledriver. Yuchi would then go over and wrap a chain around Sayama's neck, and then Onita would begin ripping the tiger mask off of Sayama, but Sayama would manage to fight back and hit a diving headbutt on Onita, and then place Onita in a chicken wing, when Yaguchi would end up just hitting the ring and begin attacking Sayama with the barbed wire bat, and then doing the accidental hitting of Onita with the barbed wire bat spot, allowing Sayama to grab the bat and begin using it on Onita, when Tiger Shark would hit the ring and hit a diving headbutt, as the referee would roll back in the ring to count in one of the worst kickouts that would ever take place, as Sayama would just kind of move move off Onita. Sayama then would end up looking to put Onita in a figure four when Onita would end up setting a fireball at Sayama to get disqualified. So third singles match, and this is the second match in a row that there's a screw job finish because these guys don't want a job to one another. Yuguchi would come over and begin helping Onita attack when Riki Choshu would hit the ring and hit Yuguchi with a chair and then hit the referee as Onita would make his way out. Onita would call out Choshu and Sayama, with Choshu having to hold Sayama back, and then Choshu would go after Onita, but only managed to hit Yuguchi with the chair as Onita would end up heading to the back. This would look to set up another Onita and Choshu feud once again, but nope, nothing. They would never end up facing off against one another, and the Onita-Sayama feud would end up taking another year-plus hiatus after this. The fireball was a cool spot, but everything else was really bad, as this feud has just continued to get worse and worse from a quality standpoint, and it should have ended after the first singles match back in June 2012, but they felt like there was still money to be made, and so they're going to keep doing it, but they don't want a job to one another, so we get a match like this as a result.
The deathmatch tournament would begin on August 21st in Shinkiba. Can you go over the first round tournament matches on the show?
So they would announce a crowd of 229 fans, which I would consider a disappointment, even though it did better than most Freedom shows typically do at Shinkiba, but this is a down number compared to what the Onita Kasai feud was doing over the last couple months, and usually the deathmatch tournament would do really well at Shinkiba, but I think this is kind of the first sign that the deathmatch tournament is on the decline as far as interest with the fans. The first match is going to be a false count anywhere deathmatch between Minoru Fujita and Brahmin Key. Fujita would jump Key right away on the ramp and do a sunset flip on the ramp before walking around ringside, and Shu would end up smashing a street sign over Fujita. Key would end up charging at Fujita, but he would move out of the way and Key would end up running into the wall instead. They would end up fighting on the floor doing chain wrestling moves before moving it up into the stands, with Key pouring water on Fujita and then bringing him in the ring, as Shu would spit Indian ink with Key holding Fujita, but Fujita would move out of the way and Key would end up getting it in the face instead, followed by Fujita hitting a tombstone piledriver, but Shu would pull the referee out to make the save and then try to do the twin magic spot like last year, spreading Indian ink on his face and then taking Key's spot in the match while no one was looking, and then spit Indian ink in Fujita's face, but Fujita would kick out still, and then Key would accidentally end up hitting Shu over the head with the street sign, and Fujita would roll Key up with a Sasuke segue for the win, so Fujita advances. Then the next match is going to be Susumu taking on Kenji Fukimoto in a Scramble Bunkhouse death match. Susumu would end up grabbing the barbed wire bat first and using it on Fukimoto. Susumu would then end up putting the bat in Fukimoto's shirt and delivering a splash off the top onto it. They would end up taking turns hitting one another across the chest with the bat, with Susumu moving out of the way during one of the swings and trying to deliver a Hurricane Rana, but Fukimoto would catch him and hit a powerbomb on him and then finish Susumu off with a brainbuster on the barbed wire bat for the win. So Fukimoto now advances. Then the next match is going to be Violento Jack taking on Hiroki. Hiroki would end up knocking Jack out of the ring and delivering a moonsault off the turnbuckle onto him. Hiroki would then end up taking a bottle of tequila that Jack had brought to the ring and spit it in Jack's face and then begin shoving it down Jack's mouth and then hit him with a trance rave kick. Hiroki then would end up going up to the top as Jack would end up getting up as well and then suplexing Hiroki off the top and then delivering a swanton bomb on him and then finishing Hiroki off with a package power driver in probably the least death match of the death match tournament ever. Then the next match is Masashi Takeda taking on Toru Sugawara. Sugawara would end up jumping Takeda right away and delivering a topeka and hilo on Takeda on the outside. They would end up getting back in the ring and Takeda would end up pulling out thumbtacks and slamming Sugawara on them and then delivering a flip off the turnbuckle with Sugawara managing to kick out. Takeda would then end up delivering a slam to Sugawara and then a yurenagi with Sugawara still kicking out, and then Sugawara would fight back and hit a Spanish fly off the top with both of them landing on the thumbtacks, but Takeda would be just too much for Sugawara and end up hitting him with a German suplex, then an Olympic slam, and then finishing him off with a U-crash for the win. So Takeda advances to the next round against the deathmatch rookie. Then the winger would take on Kamui in the next match. They would start off by fighting up the bleachers at Shinkiba before Kamui would end up climbing up to the second level of the bleachers and delivering a moonsault, and then setting up a board on a stack of chairs against the apron and hitting a Death Valley Bomb, sending the winger through the board. Kamui would then end up setting a stack of chairs and delivering a Hurricane Rana and then a Swanton Bomb on the stack of chairs to the winger. The winger would manage to fight back, kicking Kamui low and then rolling him up, but Kamui would come back and kick the winger low and then pick him up and hit a Shrike Drop for the win. So the winger's gimmick is that he either wins the tournament or he can't get out of the first round, and this is another year that he can't get out of the first round. Then the next match is going to be Takashi Sasaki taking on the one-man crew in a barbed wire board death match. Crew would end up jumping Takashi right away and throwing him into the barbed wire board. Crew would then try to send Takashi into it again, but Takashi would manage to escape and throw Crew into it instead. And then Crew would begin just tossing the barbed wire board at Crew's head and then laying him over it and just begin smashing the barbed wire board over Crew with a chair. Crew would then come back and hit a powerbomb to Takashi on the barbed wire board, but then he would end up setting the barbed wire board up on a stack of chairs with Takashi getting up and tossing Crew on it instead, followed by delivering a right kick to the board right in Crew's face, and then placing Crew in the sharpshooter on the barbed wire board with Crew tapping out. So Takashi Sasaki gets the win and advances to the next round. And then the main event's gonna be Mammoth Sasaki taking on Jun Kasai in a TLC death match. Mammoth would end up jumping Kasai right away with a chair shot, and then end up taking Kasai to the rampant Shinkiba and hitting a running powerbomb, sending him into the ring where the table with razors on it were placed, as Kasai would end up going through the table with the razors on it. Mammoth would then try to throw Kasai on it again, but Kasai would counter and suplex Mammoth on the table with razors on it, and then hit a Pearl Harbor splash with Mammoth getting up right away and trying to hit a 29 years old, but he would not have the strength to pick Kasai up. Mammoth would then place Kasai on the top turnbuckle and hit a Mammoth home run on him, and then try to suplex him on a stack of chairs, but Kasai would get up under Mammoth and hit a powerbomb, sending Mammoth on the stack of chairs. Kasai would then place a chair over Mammoth's head and hit his own Mammoth home run on him, with Mammoth still managing to kick out. Kasai would then place a stack of light tubes and then hit a Pearl Harbor splash, breaking light tubes over Mammoth, but Mammoth would again kick out. They would end up begin striking one another, with Mammoth getting a headbutt in and then taking a swing at Kasai, but Kasai would move out of the way and hit a lariat, and then place Mammoth in a scorpion deathlock between his arms, with Mammoth tapping out to establish Kasai's new submission finisher for this tournament. So Kasai gets the win, he advances, Mammoth is out of the tournament. This would be Mammoth giving Kasai his win back for their 2007 Corrigan Hall WEW title match that Mammoth won, as Mammoth was the bigger star back then, but now Kasai has surpassed everybody and he's become the top star of the promotion and the most beloved. And this match was good overall, but nothing compared to the 2007 match I just mentioned that they both had with one another.
The second round deathmatch tournament matches would take place on August 24th in Osaka. Can you talk about those matches for us?
So the first match of this show is going to be Masashi Takeda taking on Brahmin Shu in a jack-in-the-box death match. Shu would actually be the only one to get a bye in this tournament, just simply because they didn't want to have two Brahmin brother matches on the same show. They already had Key in a first-round match, so Shu gets the bye here to take on Takeda. And in this match, Takeda, he would bring a towel to the ring, and just as Shu would go to spit water in his face before the bell would even ring, Takeda would raise the towel up to block the water and then spit water in Shu's face instead. They would end up both grabbing a bag of dog food and then begin hitting one another with the dog food, covering the ring, and then Takeda would charge at Shu, but Shu would throw powder in Takeda's face. Takeda would end up fighting back and hitting a suplex on Shu on a stack of chairs, and then he would end up being given a notice that there would be a box in the back of the building that he needed to go open, so Takeda would go to the back of the building and open it up, expecting a new weapon to use, but it would end up being Brahmin Key who would pop out of the box, and both Shu and Key would then end up double-teaming Takeda before Takeda would end up suplexing both of them. Key would end up spitting Indian ink in Takeda's face, and Shu would end up rolling Takeda up, but Takeda would manage to kick out, and then Key would then try to hit Takeda with the stop sign, but Takeda would end up grabbing it and hitting Key, knocking him out, and then Takeda would place barbed wire over Key and then pick Shu up and hit a U-crash on him, with him landing directly on Key, who has barbed wire all over him, and Takeda would end up pinning both of them to get the win. So Takeda now moves on to the semifinals of the tournament. Then Minoru Fujita would take on Violento Jack in a ladder death match. Jack would end up sending Fujita to the outside and climb up to the top, but as he would go to dive off the top, he would be met by a chair thrown at him by Fujita. Jack would end up coming back though and stapling a flyer to Fujita's head and then try for a swanton, but Fujita would move out of the way and Jack would end up landing on his feet, but he would be met by a dropkick by Fujita, sending him into the ladder in the corner. They would end up climbing up the ladder and Jack would end up suplexing Fujita off of it, and then Jack would end up diving off of the ladder. Fujita out of nowhere would try to deliver a Hurricane Rana, but he would end up getting picked up by Jack and then powerbombed on the ladder, and then Jack would finish Fujita off with a package pile driver on the ladder for the win. So Violento Jack now advances to the semifinals. And then Takashi Sasaki would take on Kenji Fukimoto in a thumbtacks death match. Fukimoto would try to attack Takashi right away by throwing thumbtacks at him, with Takashi moving out of the way, and then Takashi would end up suplexing Fukimoto on the tacks, and then delivering a kick, and then following that up with placing a tack in Fukimoto's head. But Fukimoto would end up picking Takashi up and just dropping him on the thumbtacks. But Fukimoto would then end up climbing up to the top, and Takashi would end up climbing up as well and suplexing him off the top, and then take Fukimoto's boot off and drop his barefoot on the thumbtacks, and then deliver a kick to the head and place Fukimoto in the sharpshooter for the win. So now Takashi Sasaki has advanced to the semifinals of the tournament. Then the main event's going to be Jun Kasai versus Kamui in a fluorescent light tubes death match. Kamui would jump Kasai right away and deliver a drop kick, sending him into the light tubes, with Kasai heading to the outside, but Kamui would deliver an acai moonsault onto him. Kamui would then break a light tube and begin cutting open Kasai, and then deliver a flying drop kick, and then try to hit a hurricane rana off the top, sending Kasai on a stack of light tubes, but the light tubes would fail to break. Kamui would then grab a ladder and place a light tube on top of the ladder, and then the ladder over Kasai, and deliver a swanton bomb, breaking the light tube over Kasai, but Kamui would still not manage to put Kasai away. Kamui would then climb up to the top of the ladder, but Kasai would end up grabbing a light tube and climb up the ladder as well and smash it over Kamui's head, and then suplex him off the ladder, and then hit a lariat, and then a Pearl Harbor splash off the ladder with a light tube over Kamui, but Kamui would end up still managing to kick out, and then Kasai would go for the kill with the lariat, but Kamui would roll Kasai up with the Kamui clutch out of nowhere, with Kasai barely managing to kick out, and then Kamui would end up kicking Kasai low and delivering a Pele kick and go for a lariat, but he would be met with a lariat by Kasai instead, and then Kasai would end up hitting Kamui with a reverse tiger driver and then placing Kamui in the scorpion deathlock around Kamui's arm to get the win. The crowd, who were very pro Kamui due to him being from Osaka, would let out a loud groan seeing Kamui submit and Kasai win, as the final four going into the last day of the tournament at Korgan is going to be Kasai, Takashi Sasaki, Takeda, and Violento Jack.
The semifinals and finals for the deathmatch tournament would take place on August 29th at Corrigan Hall. Can you go over the matches and the significance that came with the result of the main event?
They would announce a crowd of 807 fans for this show, which is a disappointing number, I would say, considering that usually the August Corrigan Hall show is the biggest show of the year with the deathmatch tournament finals, and this year, the May 2nd show did even better. So definitely a disappointment here to only draw that many fans, and going forward, they're going to kind of take notice that the deathmatch tournament is not what it was a couple years ago. So the first semifinals tournament match is going to be a barbed wire board death match between Takashi Sasaki and Masashi Takeda. Takeda would start up by throwing Takashi towards a ladder in the corner, with Takashi stopping short and then grabbing Takeda and just throwing him into the barbed wire board in the corner, and then using the barbed wire to cut open Takeda. Takashi then would just begin grabbing chairs and just throwing them at Takeda's head, and with the last one being a perfect strike, Takeda would fight back and slam Takashi onto the barbed wire board and then place Takashi on a table with the barbed wire board over him and climb up the top of the ladder, but Takashi would get up and throw a chair at Takeda, and then Takashi would end up climbing up the ladder and suplexing Takeda off of it onto the barbed wire board, but Takeda would mostly miss the table, as the table would not even break, and Takeda would only kind of hit the barbed wire board, as he would end up no-selling it anyway. Takashi and Takeda would then begin striking one another, with Takashi powerbombing Takeda on the barbed wire board and then placing him in the sharpshooter on that barbed wire board, as the fans would passionately be chanting for Takeda here, as he would manage to break out of the move and then deliver a suplex on the ladder. Takeda would then hit an Olympic slam on Takashi and then place the barbed wire board over him and dive off the ladder, but Takashi would still manage to kick out. Takeda would then just straight out punch Takashi in the face and then deliver a German suplex to him to get the win to advance to the finals. Then the next semifinals match is going to be a razor cross board death match between Violento Jack and Jun Kasai, and they would start off by brawling in the crowd right away, with Jack throwing Kasai into the wall of Corrigan before bringing him back in the ring, where Jack would end up stapling a flyer to Kasai's face and then his t-shirt to Kasai's forehead before ripping it off. Jack would then begin pounding Kasai's forehead into the razor crossboard and then pick Kasai up and just ram his back into the razors. Kasai would end up fighting back and throw Jack's head into the razor crossboard and then place the razor crossboard over Jack and hit a Pearl Harbor splash, but he would screw up and place the razors facing him, so his stomach would end up going into the razors instead. Jack would then place the razor crossboard over Kasai and go up to the top, where Kasai would meet him at the top, but Jack would manage to suplex Kasai on that Razor Cross board. Kasai would end up fighting back and hitting Jack with a lariat, and then kick Jack low, and then deliver a reverse Tiger Driver and a Pearl Harbor Splash, this time with the Razor Cross board the right way, as Kasai would begin smashing the Razor Cross board over his own head, and then place the Scorpion arm lock around Jack's arm to make Jack tap out. So Kasai ends up moving on to the finals. This was a disappointing singles match between these two, especially how awesome the tag match that they had back in Christmas, but I'm sure Kasai wanted to make sure that he'd save something going into the finals. Then the main event's going to be a no-canvas glassboard death match between Jun Kasai and Masashi Takeda. This is going to be the finals of the death match tournament, and they would square off face-to-face before starting the match. Takeda would end up taking a chair and just smashing it over Kasai's head, which would just piss Kasai off, but Takeda would be ready and manage to suplex Kasai on the boards in the ring. Takeda would then take a chair and place it on Kasai's head and then smash that chair against Kasai's head, followed by a slam on the chair. Takeda would then try to send Kasai in the corner with the glassboard, but Kasai would reverse it and send Takeda going into the glass board instead, causing the glass to explode everywhere. Kasai would then set up a stack of chairs outside the ring and slam Takeda off the bleachers into the stack of chairs. Kasai would then tie up Takeda on a table outside the ring and climb up to the second level of Corrigan and do his balcony dive to an enormous pop as the fans are screaming for Kasai, much louder than the previous time he did it against Shuji Ishikawa at the Christmas Deathmatch show back in 2011. Kasai would visibly ask Takeda if he was alright, as Takeda would be screaming in pain while Kasai would be holding his knee. This would mark 10 years since Kasai's first time falling from the balcony, as well as his last. Kasai would end up making it back in the ring, and Takeda would crawl to the ring with his shoulder all bloody in a really cool scene. Takeda would then make it back to the ring with Kasai delivering a lariat, and then a reverse Tiger Driver, and then place the other glass board on a stack of chairs over Takeda's body. But Takeda would roll out from under and climb up to the top and meet Kasai as they would begin striking one another until Takeda would headbutt Kasai and then suplex Kasai off the top, sending him through the other glass board. Takeda would then deliver a German suplex on the hardwood boards, but Kasai would no-sell it and lariat Takeda, and then place Takeda in the arm scorpion lock, which had won him every match in the tournament so far, but Takeda would break free and place Kasai in the ankle lock as the fans are screaming for Kasai, and then Kasai would deliver an enziguri to break Takeda's hold. They would both get up and begin striking one another until Takeda would just begin slapping the crap out of Kasai, and then deliver a knee, sending Kasai out of the ring, where he would just lay outside looking like he was dead. They would both get in the ring and begin slapping each other once again, with Takeda getting the upper hand once again and delivering a knee to Kasai, and then hit a German suplex on him with Kasai managing to kick out, and then Takeda would deliver a dragon suplex and get the win. This was an awesome match. It had great heat for a building that was nowhere near filled. It sounded filled with how loud the fans were. Kasai would end up presenting the deathmatch trophy as a sign of respect. This would climax the 5-year storyline of Kasai always beating Takeda at least once a year, with Takeda slowly getting better and finally reaching Kasai's level and winning the deathmatch tournament in the process. I've talked about it before, but Takeda grew up worshipping Kasai, and so this was a really big deal for him to finally defeat his mentor and in the process win the deathmatch tournament.
Atsushi Onita and Akebono would have another exploding barbed wire deathmatch on August 31st at the Yokohama Bunka Gym. Can you go over this match, all the gimmicks that were used here, and the story behind everything leading to this match?
So this show would be entitled Yokohama Fireworks. It's going to be put on by 01 and Ribera Steakhouse. Just like last year's Yokohama Bunka Gym show with Onita and Akebono and a No Ropes Exploding Barbed Wire Death Match, they're going to do it again here. Except this time, instead of Onita and Akebono just wrestling on themselves, because now that's been done. You know, they did the August show last year, and then they've done February, and you know, the blood rivalry's kind of done, so they kind of need to change things up. So now Onita, he's going to go by the Great Nita gimmick, which he had brought back over the summer, you know, his Great Muta-like gimmick. And the original plan was for him to face off against Akebono going under his old Great Bono gimmick, which was a Great Muta-like gimmick that he had done years back in Hustle. Well, then that would end up getting changed to Great Nita taking on Kilauea, which would be a new Akebono gimmick, which was based off the Hawaiian volcano Kilauea. And that match was actually moved down to the semi-main event. I'll go over in a second probably why that was the case. Well, then it would get switched again, and now the Great Nita is going to face off against Akebono's new gimmick, Killer Anywhere, with nobody having any idea what that means. And it's back on as the main event of this show, and it's going to be a No Ropes Exploding Barbed Wire Megaton Human Bomb Death Match. So with Onita and Akebono and their rivalry kind of having ended back in February, at least as far as them hating one another, and it looked like the feud was over, well, you know, they still made money the last time they wrestled, so hey, let's see if we can make money again. And so instead of, you know, focusing on them hating each other and, you know, you have to have something new here as a result, they decide that the stipulation's going to be the draw here, and that's the aspect of it being a human bomb deathmatch, where an actual individual is going to explode during this match. And Onita would announce that he wanted All Japan president Nubo Shirashi to be the human bomb in this explosion match. Shirashi would hear this, he would turn down Onita's offer, he wants nothing to do with it. Onita gets upset by that, and as the great Onita, he demonstrates what the stipulation is, hitting a mannequin with Shirashi's face attached to it, and the whole mannequin would explode. Well, that takes us to August 31st at the Yokohama Bunka Gym, with Onita coming to the ring as the Great Onita and Akebono coming to the ring as Killer Anywhere, which he's dressed up to look like the Kilauea volcano, so I don't know what the difference between his name being Kilauea and Killer Anywhere, even though they kind of sound the same, but I'm guessing that was the look he was going for when he originally announced that he was going to be Kilauea. And so this is going to be a no-ropes exploding barbed wire, and they're going to keep the human bomb explosion element to this match. When Shirashi and Kenzo, who is an All Japan wrestler, they would come to the ring. So even though Shirashi had said, "I'm not coming to the show, leave me alone," he would end up coming to the show with Kenzo and sitting down in the front row and watching this match. Well, the match would start off, and Onita would end up charging at Akebono right away, but Akebono would end up grabbing Onita and end up spitting mist in his face, and then throwing Onita in the exploding barbed wire, and then follow that up by just throwing him at it again, and then delivering an elbow drop and trying to pin Onita, but Onita would manage to kick out. Akebono would then lift Onita up, and Onita would end up spitting mist in Akebono's face to escape. Onita would then go to the outside and escape, with Akebono going after him, and then Onita would end up grabbing a barbed wire bat and hitting Akebono with it, and then getting back in the ring with Akebono coming back as well, and then Onita would end up spitting mist again in Akebono's face, and then Onita would end up turning on the exploding barbed wire bat and hit Akebono across the stomach with it, causing him to back into the exploding barbed wire. And that's when Shirashi would decide that he wanted to participate in this match, and he would end up putting on the explosion vests, and with Kenzo trying to stop him, but Shirashi goes, "No, I want to take part in this." Akebono would end up coming back and spitting mist in Onita's face, but Onita would come back and throw a fireball that would end up hitting Akibono's chest, causing him to just get out of the ring. Kenzo would end up just rushing in the ring, and Onita would end up spitting mist in his face, and then throwing Kenzo into the exploding barbed wire, and then Shirashi would rush the ring and charge at Onita with the vest exploding, as he would push Onita into the exploding barbed wire board for a double explosion, and then Onita would all of a sudden just pin Shirashi and get the win. Akebono was already halfway out of the arena at this point by the time Onita got the win, so he knew, all right, I'm done the fireball spot and I'm out of here. So this match was just hot garbage, just thrown together with explosions. Onita and Akebono were just doing all the same spots, but because of politics, Onita not wanting to do the job, Akebono not being allowed to do the job because he was the All Japan Triple Crown champion at this time, it would end up with this finish making no sense, as Shirai was not a part of the match and somehow still pinned like this was WCW and Hulk Hogan's pinning Ric Flair in a match against Vader back in 1995. Afterwards, Onita would end up applauding Shirashi for being a part of this explosion match, as this was a PR move to be respected by the fans who just hated him as the owner, and eventually Shirashi would end up just being forced out of All Japan altogether by the wrestlers, and is just out of the business because so many people hated him. But like I said, this was Shirashi's attempt to be like, hey, look, I'm willing to be exploded. You guys should just respect me like you respect Onita. And Onita's given me the thumbs up that I'm worth it, but did not work out, and Shirashi would end up being kicked out, like I said. Onita would end up helping Shirashi to the back, and it would end up being the last that they would interact with one another afterwards. So this feud had completely ran its course by now, but they had actually planned on this match happening one more time the following year in August 2014, but Akebono's health would prevent that from happening, and they would end up just canceling that. So this is actually the end of the Onita versus Akebono feud. It would be later announced that Onita had won the match because Shirashi had been exploded, and they said, so again, they're announcing the part of the stipulation afterwards, that because Onita had caused a person to be exploded in the human explosion match, Onita was decided the winner, and he just happened to pin Shirashi anyway. So like I said, didn't really make any sense, but they try and explain it afterwards, after not having explained it while it was going on. But anyway, Akebono, like I said, politics, he's the All Japan Triple Crown champion at this point. He actually would sign a contract with All Japan the very next day. And like I said, this was the end of a very successful feud that made Onita relevant again. Although Onita has very successfully managed to keep himself relevant since this. But this ending of the feud was a complete disaster. Like I said, politics and just, there was nothing else to do. The feud should have ended back in February. But again, hey, there was money to be made, and they felt like they could do one more time with this match, and I don't know how well this show did. They didn't announce attendance or anything like that, but it was a complete disaster in the ring, and Onita now is going to be focusing on other wrestlers in exploding barbed wire death matches going forward.
Freedoms would then run their big special show in Iwate on September 16th. Can you go over the attendance for the show and the top matches?
So they would announce a crowd of 938 fans, which is down considerably from the previous year's show at this building, but that show was the biggest number Freedoms had ever done, and they had Tatsumi Fujinami and Riki Choshu on that show. This show, the only outsiders that they're really bringing in are Atsushi Onita and Yoshihiro Takayama, and this show just didn't have the buzz that the previous show did as a result. So Onita's going to team up with Mama Sasaki, Ichiro Yaguchi, and Hideki Osaka. They're going to take on Jun Kasai, Kamui, Kenji Fukimoto, and Toru Sugawara in a barbed wire board death match. Onita would go after Kasai right away and throw him outside the ring, and they would begin brawling in the crowd as all eight wrestlers would end up brawling before Onita and Yaguchi would get back in the ring with Kasai as Onita would end up hitting Kasai with a barbed wire bat. Onita and Yaguchi would then throw Kasai at the barbed wire board, but Onita would end up charging at him, and Kasai would move out of the way with Onita going into the barbed wire board. Kasai would then set up a table with Fukimoto and Sugawara trying to suplex Hosaka through the table, but the table would not end up breaking, so Kasai and Fukimoto would then suplex Mammoth through it instead and actually break it. Kasai then would end up going up to the top for a Pearl Harbor splash when Onita would knock him off and then come in and begin smashing everybody over the head with the broken table piece, including Sugawara, with the table actually getting stuck on his head, and Sugawara is struggling to get it off his head. Onita would then go to powerbomb Sugawara on the barbed wire board, with Kasai rushing over to try and make the save, only to be met in the face by red mist spit by Onita. Onita would then end up hitting a powerbomb on Sugawara on the barbed wire board, and then Mammoth would hit a choke slam, and then a 29 years old on Sugawara on the barbed wire board for the win. So this feud taking a 2.5 month pause and then resuming it pretty much killed any steam this feud had, as well as adding more people into the matches now, and there's no sign that there's actually going to be an Onita Kasai singles match. So you had a red hot feud back in June, and now it's September, and it looks like it's dead already. Then the main event's going to be a fluorescent light tubes death match for the King of Freedom's world title, with Takashi Sasaki defending it against Masashi Takeda. Takeda would end up grabbing a stack of light tubes and charging at Takashi, but Takashi would manage to move out of the way, causing Takeda to run into the corner with the light tubes breaking across him. Takashi would then try to powerbomb Takeda on a ladder with light tubes on it, but Takeda would end up managing to escape and then deliver a Uranagi, sending Takashi into the light tubes on the ladder. Takeda would then climb up the top of the ladder, but Takashi would end up climbing up the ladder as well and smash a light tube over his head and then suplex Takeda off that ladder. Takashi would then take a stack of light tubes and place them near Takeda's head and go for the right kick, but Takeda would move out of the way and swing at Takashi with the light tubes, but Takashi would move out of the way and deliver a kick to Takeda, breaking the light tubes across his chest. Takashi would then take another stack of light tubes over Takeda's head and deliver a right kick, breaking them over his head, as Takashi would get the win. Disappointing match. The building is just so spacious, and it just had no real heat, despite there being nearly 1,000 people in it. And this match was really nothing special either, and with Takeda losing, it pretty much negated his entire deathmatch tournament win, as well as finally beating Kasai, and they would just go back to him being a semi-main eventer at this point. So overall, a disappointing match and a disappointing booking decision on what they're doing with Takeda at this point. Just kind of pushing him back as if the big wins that he just had a month earlier didn't even happen.
Big Japan would hold a show on September 25th at Corrigan Hall, with it becoming the final match for a former FMW wrestler. Can you go over this match and the main event match as well?
So Big Japan's doing their tag team tournament around this time period, and Yoshihiro Sasaki and Ryuji Ito, they're going to enter as a tag team here, which is a cool thing because Yoshihiro is a strong style guy and Ryuji Ito is a deathmatch guy, and so they don't really team up very often. Well, they're going to take on the tag team of Suomo Osugi and Hercules Singa, a junior heavyweight high-flying team. Ito and Singa, they would start off by doing a dueling chair spot with one another, with Ito knocking the chair away from Singa, and then Osugi would come in and deliver a double dropkick with Singa to Ito. Yoshihiro would then square off against Osugi, who would end up dropkicking Yoshihiro out of the ring, and then Singa would end up running and jumping off a chair and delivering a sky twister press off the top on Yoshihiro on the outside, with Yoshihiro's leg landing really awkward. I'll go over more about that in a second. Osugi would then throw a chair at Ito, but Ito would end up catching that chair, and then Osugi would try to dropkick it, but Ito would end up moving out of the way, and then Ito would end up just throwing the chair at Osugi and delivering a moonsault off the top. Singa and Yoshihiro would then both come in, and Yoshihiro would end up picking Singa up and placing him on the top rope and looking to hit a Death Valley bomb, but Singa would counter and try to hit a Hurricane Rana on Yoshihiro, but then Yoshihiro would manage to block it, but Osugi would come over and he would deliver a Hurricane Rana to Yoshihiro. Singa would then deliver a super kick to Yoshihiro, but as he would charge at him, he would be met by a lariat from Yoshihiro, and then Yoshihiro would grab a stack of chairs and lift Singa up and deliver an Argentina coaster to get the win. Yoshihiro's theme would begin to play, which is the FMW theme song, and sadly, this would be the last time that the FMW theme song would play for Yoshihiro. Afterwards, it would be announced that Yoshihiro had blown his knee out when Singa had done that sky twister press off the top, and Yoshihiro's leg had landed really awkwardly. Yoshihiro would end up getting surgery on his right knee with the thought that he'd be back in about a year, but the surgery would not be a success, and then Yoshihiro would end up getting surgery again, and his knee would never actually be able to recover to a point where he'd be able to get back in the ring. Big Japan would end up paying him for the rest of 2014, so the following year, feeling like he was going to come back, but then after they realized he wasn't going to be able to come back, they would silently end up just letting him go from his Big Japan contract at the beginning of 2015, and Yoshihiro Sasaki would just end up silently retiring from pro wrestling, no retirement ceremony or anything like that. After Yoshihiro would retire, he would end up meeting a woman named Minaku, who was famous for being a reality TV star in Japan. Her and her husband and their five kids together had a show. It was kind of the equivalent of John and Kate plus eight. This show did great ratings. It was on national TV, and they would end up getting a divorce after the show ended. And Yoshihiro and Minaku would end up getting married in 2015. Well, to support his new family, well, like I said, she has five kids coming into the marriage, and then her and Yoshihiro have another kid, so now Yoshihiro has to support six kids. He becomes a bus driver to try and help support his family. Well, Minaku, because of her fame, and like I said, she was, you know, tabloid famous, you know, people knew her, and, you know, because of this new development, Fuji TV gets in contact with them, and they go, hey, let's have a reality show based off you guys. And so Fuji TV begins airing a TV show based off Yoshihiro and Minaku and their six kids with one another. And Yoshihiro would end up actually appearing at Shadow WX's MLW show back in December 2019, but he's done nothing as far as a wrestling match or anything like that since this September 2013 match. And then the main event's going to be Jun Kasai and Jackie Numazawa taking on Daisuke Sekimoto and Yuji Okabayashi. Okabayashi, he would have to be held back by Sekimoto because he looks like he wants to kill Numazawa. Eventually, he would get loose and go after Numazawa, but he would miss the lariat and Numazawa would roll him up, but Okabayashi would kick out, and then Kasai would end up hitting Okabayashi over the head with a chair. Kasai and Sekimoto would then begin brawling on the stage outside the ring as Okabayashi and Numazawa would brawl around ringside, with Okabayashi getting busted open by Numazawa. Sekimoto would end up getting tagged in and begin exchanging strikes with Kasai before Okabayashi would come over, and both Sekimoto and Okabayashi would try to suplex Kasai, but Kasai would grab a hold of Numazawa to block it before Sekimoto would take Numazawa out, but then charge at Kasai, who would move out of the way, with Sekimoto accidentally nailing Okabayashi. Numazawa would then come in and place chairs over Okabayashi and deliver a flip off the top onto him, with Sekimoto making the save by grabbing Numazawa and suplexing him. Sekimoto and Okabayashi would then double suplex Kasai, sending him across the ring in a really cool spot. Okabayashi would then go for a dive off the top, but Numazawa would move out of the way, and Kasai would then hit a Pearl Harbor splash on Okabayashi. Numazawa would then go for a last ride powerbomb on Okabayashi on a stack of chairs, but Okabayashi would escape and powerbomb Numazawa, sending him onto the chairs for the win. This was okay, but nothing compared to what they were doing a couple years ago. But like I made mention earlier, Numazawa is just not the same as he was a couple years ago either. And there was no electricity from the crowd just like there was a couple years ago as well.
The final match between Onita and Kasai would take place in Freedoms on September 27th at Shinkiba. Can you talk about this show and why the Onita and Kasai feud came to an end?
So they would announce a crowd of 184 fans, which is the lowest number that they've done with Onita on the card. And with Onita in the main event, this is proof right here that the Kasai-Onita feud is pretty much done. The interest is gone. That 2.5 month pause, like I said, just kind of killed it. And there's really just no sign that this is going anywhere. And now the Shinkiba number is back to normal, even with Onita on the show. So on this show, though, Great Kajika is going to team up with Yusaku Ito, and they're going to take on the Brahmin Brothers. Karate Brahmin would do a demonstration before the match, breaking vegetables over his head before failing to break a concrete block over his head. The Brahmin Brothers would end up, along with Karate Brahmin, triple teaming Kajika, with Karate being given a suitcase to throw at Kajika, but he would end up missing it and hitting Key in the head, with Kajika then delivering a chokeslam to pick up the win. Then the main event's going to be Jun Kasai and Takashi Sasaki taking on Atsushi Onita and Mama Sasaki in a barbed death match. Onita and Takashi, they would begin going at it at first, with Onita taking Takashi all over the building up to the ramp at Shinkiba, before Takashi and Kasai would end up meeting in the ring and then double teaming Onita, with Kasai delivering a headbutt to Onita's crotch. Kasai then would end up grabbing a stack of light tubes, but as he would go to hit Onita over the head with it, Mammoth would come over and grab the light tubes from him and smash it over Kasai's head. Onita would then try to powerbomb on Takashi on the barbed wire board, but Kasai would come over to make the save. Mammoth would then try to send Takashi into the barbed wire board, but Takashi would reverse it and send Mammoth into it instead, and then charge at Mammoth in the corner with it. Kasai would then end up going up to the top for a Pearl Harbor splash, but Onita would end up hitting him with a chair, knocking him down, and then Onita would spit green mist in Takashi's face and then hit a powerbomb on a chair laid over the barbed wire board, with Kasai making the save for Takashi. Onita would then end up picking up the barbed wire bat, while Mammoth would end up holding Takashi and swing at Takashi, but Takashi would manage to move out, and Onita would end up accidentally hitting Mammoth with it, followed by Kasai hitting a Pearl Harbor splash, with the referee getting pulled out of the ring by a Jado Army member to prevent him from making the count. Takashi would then end up hitting a Michinoku Driver 2 on Mammoth, and then place a light tube next to his head and deliver a right kick to that light tube, breaking it over Mammoth's head to get the win. Afterwards, Takashi and Onita, they would begin fighting, with Takashi throwing Onita out of the ring and Kasai grabbing a stack of light tubes to make sure Onita stayed away from the ring and would just leave. So this is actually going to be the final Onita versus Freedoms match, as Onita would only make one more appearance for Freedoms a year later, and he would actually be a babyface during that, with this feud having just been forgotten by then. Like I've talked about, this feud peaked back in June, and they took that 2.5 month break, and they just never could recapture the electricity. There had been talk about a no ropes exploding barbed wire death match between Onita and Kasai, but I don't know how true that really was, or if that was really going to ever happen. As 0-1, they were the only ones really doing the exploding barbed wire matches at this time, and they were not going to actually have Kasai, someone who they never thought of highly to begin with, appear for them working for another promotion in a big show main event. But even if 0-1 really was going to actually make that match happen, I don't think it was going to happen anyway. Same reason it didn't ever end up happening in Freedoms, and that was politics, with no one wanting to do the job. Onita wasn't going to lose to Kasai. Onita has more seniority, he's a bigger name, you know, historically than Kasai, and Kasai represented this type of death match with the light tubes that Onita never really was a fan of. Then there was just no reason for Freedoms to have Kasai job to Onita, because it wasn't going to help Kasai or Freedoms job their top star and lose to Onita, and then Onita leave with Kasai just simply never getting his win back from a heel that just left the company anyway. They might have made some money off that, but they didn't feel it was worth it. I talked about it back in the 1995 episodes when Onita and Hayabusa were having their issues, how that was kind of like Bret Hart and Hulk Hogan. Well, this is kind of like Hulk Hogan and Shawn Michaels, but you have the bigger star just not wanting to job to someone who is popular, but for a different reason than you are, but they're not as popular as you were in your prime, so why job to someone you don't really care for anyway, and who represents a different era of wrestling than you represent, when you were a bigger star in that era, and that era was more popular anyway? So why job to someone when you don't want to? So what you have is this feud just kind of ending with Mama Sasaki doing all the jobs as the conclusion.
The small B168 promotion would hold Tetsuhiro Kuroda's 20th anniversary match on October 6th in Osaka. Can you talk about this match?
So Kuroda's going to reform his longtime tag team with Masato Tanaka here, and they're going to go up against Mammoth Sasaki and Hideki Osaka. Kuroda would end up getting Mammoth against the turnbuckle and do his signature comedy spots before elbowing Mammoth's knee. Kuroda would then deliver a lariat to Mammoth, but Mammoth would manage to barely kick out. Kuroda would then end up hitting Hosaka with a lariat, and then Tanaka would follow that up by hitting a sliding D on Hosaka for the win. So Tanaka gets the win on Kuroda's big show. Afterwards, Kuroda would be presented with flowers afterwards, as all four of the former FMW wrestlers would end up posing together in the ring.
0-1 would hold another exploding barbed wire death match with Onita, but this time without Akebono on October 14th in Niigata. Can you go over this match as well as how well the show did?
Yeah, so I mentioned earlier how 0-1 during this time period never announced their attendance for their shows. Well, this is going to be the exception because this show did so well that they would announce a sellout crowd of 3,500, and this building is packed. It looks like a sellout, or at least a very near sellout. The main event's going to be Atsushi Onita and Masato Tanaka going up against Yoshihiro Takayama and Nosawa Rangai in a no-ropes exploding barbed wire death match. So with the Akebono feud having ran its course, Onita now is going to move on to feuding with Yoshihiro Takayama going forward. It would not be long into the match before Nosawa would throw Tanaka into the exploding barbed wire, and then just moments later, Takayama would throw Onita in the exploding barbed wire, with the fireball being set off from the explosions, which would catch Onita and burn his face and burn his arm really badly, probably his worst injury he's ever suffered in all the years of having these exploding matches. Onita would then come back and spit red mist in Takayama's face as Onita and Takayama would brawl in the crowd, whereas Tanaka and Nosawa, they would end up going in the back of the building and begin climbing up the scaffold that was back there, with Tanaka knocking Nosawa off the scaffold and then placing Nosawa on a table and then climbing back up the scaffold and diving off of it, sending Nosawa through the table. Onita and Tanaka would end up making it back in the ring and grab another table when Onita pile-driving Nosawa through that table. And then Onita and Takayama, they would end up squaring off again, with both of them going into the exploding barbed wire together. Onita would then end up shooting a fireball in Takayama's face, which either Takayama did not feel like it connected well enough, or he just straight out sold it, as Takayama would end up just immediately delivering a knee to Onita and then hitting Tanaka with a backdrop. Onita and Tanaka would then come back and both run into Takayama, sending him into the exploding barbed wire again, and then throw Nosawa into the exploding barbed wire, with Onita hitting a thunderfire powerbomb on Nosawa for the win. This was an entertaining match, although there was a period where it dragged, but it's still a success, especially considering it did so well with so many people in the building, and how Onita was able to go through the match even though his arm would be severely burnt, and he would end up having to take some time off as a result because of this burn on his arm.
Freedoms would hold their Shinkiba show on October 30th. Can you go over some of the highlights of this show?
So they would announce a crowd of 131 fans, which is way down from what Freedoms has been doing this year. This is at the level of what they were doing without Kasai at Shinkiba the year prior. But the main event, really, it has Kasai in it, it has Takeda in it, but they're going to go up against two guys that are not usually main eventers, and as a result, this show is looked down as, you know, hey, this is a skippable show. The main event's not that interesting. It's two mid-carders taking on Kasai and Takeda. Some of the early matches, though, would be Kenji Fukimoto and Minoru Fujita taking on the Brahmin Brothers. It would be the Karate Brahmin show before the match, as Karate Brahmin would end up saying happy birthday to super fan Michelle from the UK, who does a great blog with translations and goes to a bunch of shows, especially Freedoms. Karate would end up celebrating by putting firecrackers up his nose and setting them off. Then Fujita, who's dressed up and has face paint like Fukimoto, as well as Kenji Fukimoto, would hit the ring and begin brawling with the Brahmin Brothers. Fujita would end up placing a Brahmin key on a chair and just begin messing with his hair and giving him pigtails. Karate Brahmin would then end up getting in the ring, and him and Fujita would just begin blowing bubbles at one another, with Fukimoto grabbing the bubble water and putting it in his mouth and spitting it in the Brahmin Brothers' faces. Fukimoto would then get key in a camel clutch, as Fujita would set off one of the firecrackers in key's face. And then Vegeta would end up hitting a tombstone piledriver on Ki, and then Fukimoto would end up hitting a lariat, and then a sit-down powerbomb on Ki, with Karate Brahmin coming in to make the save by squirting shampoo in Fukimoto's face. Fukimoto would try to spit the shampoo in Karate's face, but he would end up blocking it, and then Shu would come over and roll him up for the win. Another entertaining Brahmin Brothers match. Then Takashi, Sasaki, and Kamui would team up to take on Mammoth Sasaki and Hideki Osaka. Takashi and Mammoth would start up by chopping one another across their chest, and they would all end up outside the ring with Kamui hitting an Asai moonsault onto everyone. Takashi and Osaka then ended up squaring off in the ring, with Takashi acting like he was going to toss a chair right at Osaka's head, but instead would end up just throwing it at Mammoth in the corner before tagging in Kamui, but Osaka would end up going low and then hitting a Death Valley bomb on Kamui. Mammoth would end up setting up for a Mammoth home run on Takashi, but Kamui would deliver a flying dropkick to him, and then Takashi would put the chair over Mammoth's head, and then both Kamui and Takashi would hit a Mammoth home run on Mammoth, with Osaka having to rush and grab the referee to make the save. Kamui would then end up hitting a Swanton Bomb and going for a moonsault, but Osaka would end up hitting him with the barbed bat and then delivering a Hurricane Rana, and then Mammoth would go for the 29 years old, but Kamui would manage to escape and roll up Mammoth with a Kamui clutch and then go for a lariat, but he would end up being met by a lariat from Mammoth and then finished off with the 29 years old for the win. So the whole Onita vs. Kasai feud has now mostly just turned into Mammoth against the rest of Freedoms, as this would be the last match for Osaka, and Mammoth will now just be going up against Kamui pretty much for the rest of the year. Then the main events will be Jun Kasai and Masashi Takeda taking on Susumu and Toru Sugawara. This is going to be Susumu's first shot at the main event, as this was going to be a way of him paying his dues and showing that he's part of the team by getting busted open early. Then Sugawara would end up delivering a Topeko and Hilo on everyone on the outside and then hit Takeda with a flying dropkick. Susumu would then end up going up to the top against Kasai and knock him down and get a ladder and then begin climbing it, when Sugawara would end up climbing the ladder as well and tagging Susumu from behind and pretty much just kicking him off the ladder and taking over, but Takeda would end up climbing up the ladder and then begin fighting with Sugawara on top of it, when Susumu would come over and powerbomb Takeda off the ladder. Susumu would then end up going back to focusing on Kasai, but Kasai would deliver a headbutt and then a German suplex to Susumu on the ladder and then nail him with the lariat. Kasai would then go up for the Pearl Harbor Splash, but Susumu would get up his knees and roll up Kasai, with Kasai kicking out at two. Susumu would then dive off the top of the middle rope with Kasai kicking out, and then Susumu would deliver a dropkick to Kasai and cover him, with Sugawara wanting all the glory and kicking Susumu despite him being his partner, as Takeda would come over and deliver a German suplex to Sugawara. Susumu would then end up making the save for Sugawara and bring in a box of light tubes and send Takeda into them, and then climb up to the top rope and dive off onto Sugawara on the outside for him having attacked Susumu so many times as well as moments earlier. Susumu would then lay light tubes over Kasai's body and try for the splash off the top rope again, but Kasai would move out of the way and then grab the light tubes and smash them over Susumu's head and then finish him off with the reverse tiger driver, with Sugawara going after Kasai right away, but Kasai would lay him out with a reverse tiger driver on Susumu as well. Kasai would then get on the mic and tell Susumu, now that he has dealt with light tubes, the last step to becoming accepted as a real member of Freedoms was to start over and shave his head, as he would present Susumu with a razor. Susumu would shove Kasai and then grab the razor and begin shaving his own head, as he would now be accepted as a member of the locker room going forward as a Freedoms wrestler.
Big Japan would have their big end-of-the-year show on November 4th at the Yokohama Bunka Gym. Can you go over the top death matches that took place, including the death match title main event?
So on this show, Yuka Miyamoto is going to take on Masaya Takahashi. Takahashi was this wrestler for Tajiri's Wrestling New Classic promotion, which had succeeded his Smash promotion. Takahashi was pushed differently than most rookies in Japan. The traditional ways for them to lose pretty much every match for a year and just slowly build them up. Well, Takahashi had this gimmick where he would end up winning all his matches due to some type of interference happening to his opponent. And Takahashi now is looking to get more bookings than just the WNC is willing to offer. And he would begin working for Big Japan in undercard matches at the beginning of this year. And he would gradually move up the card a lot faster than a traditional young wrestler in Big Japan even, due to Big Japan seeing his potential and him having a background with WNC. So by the end of the year, he's now having marquee matches like this match against Miyamoto in a fluorescent light tubes glassboard death match. Takahashi, he would end up grabbing Miyamoto and hitting a powerbomb onto a set of light tubes, but then he would end up charging at Miyamoto and getting picked up by him and tossed into the glass board. Miyamoto would then take another stack of light tubes and deliver a moonsault, breaking the light tubes over Takahashi and getting the win. So this wasn't really anything of a match, but like I said, for him to even just get a marquee match on a big show like this against someone like Miyamoto, they obviously see potential in Takahashi. He's just really young at this point. And then the main event's gonna be Shuji Ishikawa taking on Isami Kodaka in a fluorescent light tubes bricks cage death match. Ishikawa, he would start off by picking Kodaka up and just tossing him into the cage right at the start. Kodaka would come back and knock Ishikawa down in the corner and then grab this huge stack of light tubes. And Kodaka would try to come down with them on top of Ishikawa, but he would pretty much miss, but it would still be enough for the light tubes to break and what would be a total waste of having these huge light tubes included in the match. Ishikawa would end up picking Kodaka up and then just dropping him on the bricks and then powerbombing Kodaka into the cage. Ishikawa would then try to suplex Kodaka on a stack of light tubes, but Kodaka would reverse it and suplex Ishikawa onto them instead. Kodaka would then climb up to the top of the cage and dive off of it on Ishikawa and then place the bricks on Ishikawa and then deliver a knee drop onto him. Kodaka would then climb up the top of the cage again, but Ishikawa would end up coming up with him and hit him over the head with the light tube and then suplex Kodaka off the top of the cage. Ishikawa would then end up hitting a Splash Mountain powerbomb and then a Fire Thunder on the bricks and then try for another Splash Mountain powerbomb, but Kodaka would manage to escape and deliver a kick to Ishikawa, but then he would be met by a headbutt, but Kodaka would come back and headbutt Ishikawa's chin and then deliver a kick to the head and then climb up to the top of the cage and deliver a double knee drop off the top of the cage on Ishikawa, and then Ishikawa would get up and grab Kodaka and try for another Splash Mountain powerbomb, but Kodaka would escape again and deliver a kick at Ishikawa's head and then hit a running kick to the head and get the pin on Ishikawa. So Kodaka wins the Big Japan Deathmatch title here. This was a good match overall. They're going to give Kodaka somewhat of a run here, but Kodaka really is not in the plans of the company at this point, and this was just the easiest way to book around Ishikawa losing the title, as Yuko Miyamoto is actually going to be the guy that they have plans for going forward in this company.
Takashi Sasaki would defend his King of Freedom World Championship against Jun Kasai on November 4th in Yokohama. Can you go over this match as well as the other singles match that took place?
So Mamma Sasaki's going to take on Daisuke Masaaka here. Masaaka is becoming a regular and is going to eventually become a full-time Freedoms wrestler relatively soon. And Masaaka, he would end up jumping Mammoth as Mammoth was coming to the ring and hit an Asai moonsault and then throw Mammoth in the crowd. They would end up getting back in the ring with Masaaka hitting a Hurricane Rana, and then he would end up going to the top, but Mammoth would also go up and deliver a suplex to Masaaka off the top rope and then deliver a running leg drop and then go for an awesome bomb with Masaaka reversing it and then hitting a sunset flip followed by Masaaka delivering a kick to the Mammoth's head. Masaaka would then try for a Law Magistral, but Mammoth would end up using his power just to pick up Masaaka and drop him down, and then Mammoth would end up hitting a choke slam and then finish Masaaka with a 29 years old for the win. So like I said, Masaaka going forward is going to become a regular with Freedoms, and this was him starting at the bottom. Then the main event is going to be Takashi Sasaki defending the King of Freedom's world title against Jun Kasai in a Razor Cross Board Ladder Death Match. Before the match would even start, everyone in the crowd is just chanting for Kasai, as Takashi is just looking on going, hey, I'm a face also, why aren't you chanting for me? Takashi would start the match by throwing Kasai at the Razor Cross Board, but Kasai stopping just short, and Takashi would charge at him, but Kasai would move out of the way, and Takashi would go headfirst into the Razor Cross Board. Kasai would then begin smashing Takashi over the head with a chair, and then Kasai would dropkick Takashi in the corner on the light tube set up on a ladder. Kasai would then climb up the ladder, but Takashi would climb it up as well and deliver a suplex off the ladder, but Kasai would get up right away and deliver a lariat and then a Pearl Harbor splash with Takashi kicking out. Kasai would then end up putting the Razor Cross Board over Takashi and go up to the top for a Pearl Harbor splash, but Takashi would turn the Razor Cross Board around, causing Kasai to land on the Razor side. Takashi would then powerbomb Kasai on the ladder and then pull out a stack of light tubes and deliver a kick, breaking the light tubes over Kasai's head, with Kasai still managing to kick out at one, and then Takashi would hit his own reverse tiger driver and then finished Kasai off with the D-Geist. This was really kind of the same match that they've been doing the last couple years. Really nothing new. Just a lot of the same recycled spots. Afterwards, Kenichiro Arai, he would end up coming to the ring and challenging Takashi Sasaki to a King of Freedom's world title match at the Corrigan Hall show on Christmas. Then Yuko Miyamoto, who had just wrestled a Big Japan match earlier in the day, he'd come to the ring and he would challenge Jun Kasai to a scaffold death match at the Christmas death match as well, with Kasai making fun of Takashi for the fact that he might have won this match, but he was going to be in the semi-main event at the Christmas death match, and Kasai's match against Miyamoto was going to be the main event.
the Apache Army would have a no-ropes barbed wire death match between some old FMW and Wing wrestlers on November 10th in Osaka. Can you go over this match and how well it did?
So they would announce a sellout crowd of 377 fans, so this show was a financial success for the Apache Army. I talked about it earlier, how FMW nostalgia can do well, especially in a small building like this. You bring in Onita, you have a no-ropes barbed wire death match, you have FMW versus Wing, and it can do really well in a 300-plus seat building. On this show, Onita and Kuroda, they're going to team up to take on Wing Kanemura and Hideki Osaka, so it's going to be FMW versus Wing in a no-ropes barbed wire death match, with Kanemura and Osaka taking Onita outside the ring right away and just barely throwing him in a chair before going back in the ring and grabbing Kuroda, and Hosaka would hit Kuroda with the barbed wire bat and then toss him on top of the barbed wire. Onita would then walk back in the ring and spit red mist in Kanemura's face and then begin cutting Hosaka's forehead with the barbed wire. Onita would then take Hosaka outside the ring and set him on a table and slip while pile driving him through the table as the table would kind of break. Kanemura would take a piece of the table and set up like he was going to hit Onita over the head with it, but Kuroda would come over and hit a lariat on Kanemura, and then Onita would smash the table piece over Kanemura's head. Onita would then spit mist in Kanemura's face again, and then Kuroda would hit a double lariat on Kanemura and Hosaka, and then Kuroda would hit a back suplex on Hosaka on a stack of chairs for the win. This match went less than 9 minutes, and it sucked. I mentioned earlier, Kanemura seemed like he was back after such an awesome match against Magnitude Kishiwada back in July, but along with, like, everyone else, he just looked old and slow in this match, and they were just trying to recreate an FMW barbed wire match from the 90s 15 years earlier, and none of them were capable of making it look good anymore. Kanemura afterwards would go over and hug Onita as Onita would do his Onita theater to end the show. So like I said, this was a very disappointing match, as one night these guys are still capable of having a really good match, but this was not that night.
Freedoms would then run another Shinkiba show on November 28th. Can you go over what happened with Mammoth Sasaki on it, as well as the main event?
So they went out to a crowd of 162 fans, which at this point is just a standard Freedoms show when nothing is hot. It's better than what they did the previous month, but, you know, nothing is really setting the world on fire for this promotion, and so this is just going to be the standard crowd. Mammoth Sasaki, he now has dropped the Atsushi Onita t-shirt, so the Jado Army and Onita is just completely wiped clean of Freedoms at this point. Mammoth now is going to begin wearing an alternative LeBron James jersey, and he's going to face off against Kamui here. Kamui, he would begin striking Mammoth early on, with Mammoth just coming back and hitting him with the headbutt. Kamui would end up delivering a Hurricane Rana, sending Mammoth out of the ring, followed by an Acai Moonsault to the outside. Mammoth would then charge at Kamui, but Kamui would move out of the way and Mammoth would run into the turnbuckle. Kamui would then climb up to the top and hit a flying dropkick to Mammoth's shoulder, and then Kamui would climb up to the top again, but Mammoth would get up and suplex Kamui across the ring, and then Mammoth would end up trying to hit an awesome bomb on Kamui, but Kamui would roll him up and then charge at Mammoth, who would end up grabbing Kamui and hitting a chokeslam on him, and then successfully hitting an awesome bomb and then putting Kamui away with the 29 years old. Afterwards, Toru Sugiura, he would come to the ring and bring Mammoth back in the ring, as Sugiura and Kamui would just both grab Mammoth by his legs, and then Mammoth would end up getting on the mic and announce that he was joining back up with the Freedoms group, so all is forgiven now that Mammoth is going back and he's going to become a face, and like I said, all the Onita Jado Army stuff has now been forgotten. Then the main event screen, Jun Kasai taking on Suzumu, who is sporting a fresh buzz cut at this point. Suzumu would jump Kasai right away and deliver a drop kick to him, and they begin brawling outside the ring, with Suzumu getting back in the ring busted open. Suzumu would then try for his leap from the middle of the top rope, but Kasai would move out of the way, and then kick Suzumu low and deliver a German suplex and then a tiger driver, with Kasai selling like he screwed up his knee. Kasai would then climb up to the top for a Pearl Harbor splash, with Suzumu getting his knees up to block it. Then Suzumu would hit his splash off the middle of the top rope and hit Kasai with a transrave kick, and then place Kasai in the sharpshooter, with Kasai grabbing the rope to break the move. Suzumu would then drop kick Kasai's knee and try to hit a reverse tiger driver on Kasai, but Kasai would reverse it and go for one himself, with Suzumu shoving Kasai to hit the referee in the corner, knocking him out. Kasai would then pull out a stack of light tubes and break them over his head, but Suzumu would come back and deliver a drop kick to Kasai and then cover him, but the referee would count so slowly after getting knocked out, he would only manage to get to two before Kasai would kick out and come back with a lariat to Suzumu and then finish Suzumu off with a reverse tiger driver multiple times to get the win. Afterwards, Kasai and Suzumu, they would fist bump out of respect, as Suzumu now has earned Kasai's respect and is a full-time Freedoms member at this point.
Another no-ropes exploding barbed wire death match would take place for Onita in Nagata, this time on December 13th against Yoshihiro Takayama. Can you go over this match?
Yeah, so Onita and Takayama, they're going to have another exploding barbed wire match, except this time a singles match. Takayama, he would end up delivering a boot to Onita right away, sending him into the barbed wire just moments into the match, with Onita coming back and spitting red mist in Takayama's face. They would end up grabbing one another and going into the exploding barbed wire together, and then Takayama would grab Onita and try to send him into the barbed wire once again, but Onita would reverse it and send Takayama into it instead, and then Takayama would get up and deliver a backdrop to Onita, and then come back from behind and try to suplex, but Onita would manage to turn it around and spit red mist again in Takayama's face, and then send him into the exploding barbed wire again, and then shove Takayama into it one more time just moments later. Onita would then end up hitting a DDT on Takayama and just pick up the win. This was nothing of a match. It was just explosions and very little in between, as this was a very disappointing way to end the year with the whole exploding barbed wire gimmick, which had gotten popular once again because of the nostalgia, and it was an easy way to make an easy, decent payday, and really, they didn't have to do too much in between going in the exploding barbed wire, as this match was all just exploding barbed wire spots, pretty much.
The Christmas Deathmatch show would take place for Freedoms on December 25th at Corrigan Hall. Can you go over the main matches on the show, as well as the main event scaffold deathmatch between Jun Kasai and Yuko Miyamoto?
So they would announce a crowd of 978 fans for this show, so just shy of 1,000. This show would end up doing better than any show at Corrigan for Freedoms. Sadly, you know, the Freedoms promotion, after hitting the 1,000 mark twice in back-to-back months in 2012, were unable to have a show hit the 1,000 mark in 2013. The opening match is going to be the winger Minoru Fujita and Hiroki taking on Brahmin Shu, Brahmin Ki, and Brahmin Suzumu. So Suzumu is going to be an honorary Brahmin brother for this match, and this is going to be a Tokyo homeless man deathmatch. The Brahmin brothers, they would jump everyone right at the start, with Shu going through the garbage and grabbing a soccer ball, and then Ki would end up grabbing a hold of the winger, with Shu throwing the soccer ball at the winger, but the winger would move out of the way, and Shu would end up accidentally hitting Ki with it instead. Fujita would then toss both Brahmin brothers out of the ring, as Karate Brahmin, dressed up as Santa Claus, would come in the ring and put Minoru Fujita in a headlock, with the crowd exploding, chanting for Karate, as Karate would end up going so slow that Fujita would end up just standing there, and the Brahmin brothers would come in and just toss Fujita out of the ring. Shu would then end up putting a limit on top of Karate's head and begin practicing his nunchuck skills, trying to hit the limit off Karate's head, but he would end up hitting both the limit and Karate's head. Fujita would then begin squeezing lemon juices in Karate's eyes, as Suzumu would come over and make the save by spitting water in Fujita's face, and then the Brahmin brothers would then begin stretching the winger and Hiroki's leg to create a circle, as Fujita would get in the middle and set up to hit a tombstone piledriver on Suzumu, but Karate Brahmin would end up coming over to make the save by spitting Indian ink in Fujita's face, and then Suzumu would end up rolling Fujita up with a Hurricane Rana in the circle for the win. This was a fun match, like most Brahmin brother matches, especially when Karate Brahmin's involved, so overall a really good match. And then Mammoth Sasaki's going to take on Kamui once again, and Kamui would end up throwing a chair right at Mammoth as he was entering the ring, and then tried to do a baseball slide, but Mammoth would end up grabbing Kamui and just toss him into a stack of chairs in the corner. Mammoth would then take Kamui up the stage and try to hit the 29 years old, but Kamui would manage to escape and deliver a Pele kick, knocking Mammoth off the stage, and then Kamui would end up hitting an Asai moonsault, with Mammoth kind of catching him. Kamui would then grab a barbed wire bat and then begin working on Mammoth's arm, and then end up in putting him in a Fujiwara armbar with a chair also around Mammoth's arm, and then try to hit a Hurricane Rana, but Mammoth would end up overpowering him and delivering a powerbomb to Kamui. Mammoth would then end up hitting a Mammoth home run and then wrap a barbed wire bat around Kamui's throat, with the referee stopping the match and giving the win to Mammoth. And then Takashi Sasaki would defend the King of Freedom world title against Kenichiro Arai in a barbed wire board chain death match. So Arai and Takashi are chained together, and Takashi would start off the match by hitting a lariat on Arai and then taking the barbed wire board and just falling back on it himself and telling Arai to do it as well to show how tough he is, but Arai would just fake like he was going to do it and then attack Takashi. A lot of boring legwork would then take place until Takashi would set up a barbed wire board on a stack of chairs and climb up to the top with Arai and take Arai's suit off and try to suplex Arai into the barbed wire board, but Arai would end up getting under Takashi and hit him with a power bomb, sending him into the barbed wire board instead. Arai would then end up putting his suit back on and put the barbed wire board over Takashi and dive off the top onto the barbed wire board. Takashi would then manage to wrap Arai around the neck with the chain and throw him over the top, which would knock Arai out, as Takashi would then set up the barbed wire board again on a stack of chairs and then bring Arai up to the top and take off his suit again, with Arai waking up to realize what Takashi was trying to do to him, and Takashi would end up hitting the suplex off the top, sending Arai into the barbed wire board, and then putting Arai in the sharpshooter on the barbed wire board, making him tap out as Takashi would successfully defend the title match once again. So Arai lost both the WWE title match and King of Freedom's world title match. Both these matches were entertaining, and they're not necessarily good, but that's what Arai is. I wouldn't say he's a good worker, but he's an entertaining, fun wrestler. Then the main event's going to be Jun Kasai taking on Yuko Miyamoto in a glass board scaffold death match. They would fight on the outside early on with Kasai busting Miyamoto open, and then Kasai would begin working on that cut. Kasai would then try to send Miyamoto into the first glass board, but Miyamoto would reverse it and send Kasai into it instead. Miyamoto would then climb up to the top of the scaffold and deliver a foot stomp on Kasai off of it. Kasai would then come back with the DDT to Miyamoto and then deliver a German suplex to him and then set up the other glass board on a stack of chairs. Kasai would then climb up to the top, but Miyamoto would get under him and try to powerbomb Kasai, but that would not end up working, and Miyamoto would have to get back up to the top, but Kasai would end up managing to just shove Miyamoto off the top, sending him through the other glass board, and then Kasai would end up hitting a Pearl Harbor Splash with Miyamoto kicking out right away. Kasai would then end up sending Miyamoto into the ropes, but he would do his handspring elbow spot with Kasai catching him and delivering a reverse Tiger Driver. Kasai would then climb up to the top and hit a Pearl Harbor Splash off the scaffold, but sell it like he had really messed up his knee in the process, and then Kasai would end up placing Miyamoto on a table and climb up the scaffold, but Miyamoto would end up getting up as well and climbing up the scaffold, with Kasai acting like he was going to hit a reverse Tiger Driver off the scaffold on Miyamoto, but Miyamoto would manage to escape and pick up Kasai and hit a Yankee Driver, sending Kasai off the scaffold through the table. Then Miyamoto would pick up Kasai and hit a Fire Thunder and then hit a Moonsault, with Kasai still managing to kick out. Kasai would then get up and hit a Miyamoto with a reverse Tiger Driver, but Miyamoto would still kick out, and then Kasai would try to charge at Miyamoto with the lariat, but Miyamoto would catch him and hit a Fire Thunder again, and then a moonsault off the scaffold for the win. So this was a good match overall, but as any time Miyamoto is going to be able to do his spots on a scaffold, it's going to be a good match, and the two really did go all out here, but the match was so much like the Takashi Sasaki Yuko Miyamoto match back in 2007, as Kasai's willing to take all those similar bumps that they did in that match, but the crowd really wasn't as big as the Big Japan match, and there wasn't as much heat, and probably a lot of the fans had already seen these spots before. Again, a good match, but there's a reason this match is never really kind of talked about or remembered compared to the Takashi Sasaki match back in 2007, as Big Japan still uses that match as a gimmick to try and draw for them a decade later, and this match is just kind of forgotten as a result. Still, a good match overall, and a much better match than the Kobayashi Miyamoto match that they had a year prior back in Big Japan.
Miss Mongo would debut her new WPA promotion on December 31st at Shinkiba, with a few former FMW wrestlers taking on some independent deathmatch wrestlers in a no-ropes barbed wire deathmatch. Can you go over this match?
So this match is going to be Atsushi Onita, Riki Fuji, Hideki Osaka, Miss Mongol, taking on Ichiro Yuguchi, Keizo Masuda, Yuko Miyamoto, and Saburo Inamatsu. It would not take long before they would all end up outside the ring, brawling around ringside. Onita and Yuguchi, they would end up getting in the ring and doing a dueling chair spot, with Onita getting the better end of it and smashing the chair over Yuguchi's head. They would end up setting up a table, and Onita would pile drive Inamatsu through it. Yuguchi would then come back and swing his barbed wire bat at Miss Mongol, but she would duck it, but Yuguchi would then spit red mist in her face and throw her into the barbed wire. Yuguchi would then begin using the barbed wire bat on her forehead and then toss her in the corner at a table, but Yuguchi would end up charging at her and she would move out of the way, and Yuguchi would end up running into that table. Onita would then take a broken piece of the table and begin smashing it over everyone's head. Onita and Mongo would then grab Miyamoto and double suplex him, and then Onita would end up handing Miss Mongo the barbed wire bat, and she would begin hitting all of her opponents with it, and then delivering a senton splash with the barbed wire bat laid on Matsuda. Inamatsu would grab Mongol, and Yuguchi would take the barbed wire bat and charge at her, but Miss Mongol would end up moving out of the way, with Yuguchi hitting Inamatsu with it instead. Onita would then throw Inamatsu into the barbed wire and hit a Thunderfire powerbomb, followed by Hosaka and Riki throwing him in the barbed wire once again. Miss Mongol would then try to powerbomb Inamatsu with the help of the FNW guys, but she would not be strong enough to actually pick him up, and it would be an ugly looking powerbomb, so they would try again with Mongol hitting it better this time, and managing to get the pin over Inamatsu. So the FMW team get the win here. Miss Mongo would end up getting on the mic afterwards and thank the fans for coming, with all the FMW wrestlers standing around her, before Onita would end up doing his Onita theater to end the show. This is pretty much the same thing that Miss Mongo did back in 2010, where she wants to revisit her youth, including herself in the old FMW barbed wire street fight death match, like she did back in 2010. Nothing new about this match, but like I mentioned earlier, it's cool to see the FMW name still living on here in 2013, and it's going to continue need to do so going forward, and we'll be talking about that here in the future.
All right, Brett, can you remind everybody where they can find you at?
So you can find my website at bahufmw.com or fmwwrestling.us. I have in-depth biographies of a bunch of the FMW wrestlers. I have news covering the last 20 years of anything FMW related. I have results covering the last 30 years of FMW and Freedoms. I have DVDs and MP4s for sale, which I have pretty much the entire FMW and Freedoms video library, as well as a bunch of Big Japan, Zero One, Michinoku Pro, and a bunch of other promotions, as well as you can find the history of FMW videos all linked off my site as well. Then you can find my Instagram at BahuFMWWorld, where I have about 3,500 pictures from my Japanese wrestling magazines that I've been collecting for over a decade. So I have a bunch of rare FMW pictures and really cool, interesting things that you wouldn't find anywhere else. You can also find my Twitter at BahuFMW, where I post anything FMW related news-wise or Freedoms, and I also do these one-minute videos of this day in history when it comes to a bunch of interesting FMW matches. And then also, if you want to just listen to these episodes on your phone, you can find all the episodes on iTunes as well as a bunch of other podcast sites. Just search History of FMW. And then also you can find my History of FMW Facebook group, where I, along with a bunch of other FMW fans, post a bunch of FMW related stuff. And then also you can find my YouTube at Brett FMW, where I've put back up all the History of FMW videos as well as my entire career music video collection, along with a bunch of other stuff. And I believe this count will be able to stay up for the future. And that's pretty much it.
Thanks for joining us, everyone. We'll be back next episode, where we will be going over the year 2014. See you then.